Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organizations. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational scientific research organization dedicated to show and prove of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was founded as a result of a divine vision given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kelly, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established grant schools throughout the United States and other foreign countries. In this school, we teach by the true, correct, and original name of our Heavenly Father, the Word of our Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in original Hebrew texts. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim, and it has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua, and it has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles and not names. As the Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5, that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title, which means Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language had any letters or characters in their alphabets that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in our English language until some 1600 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and correct name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He's the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on the chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word of Son, an incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifests himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world erroneously calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of the name and title may be had by reading the preface of a Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel up out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed to him this divine pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court that we're round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. Also in this school, we go about to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and how that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. We have 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this institute, and they are as follows. One is to help you find and know Yahweh as He really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Three is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature or power latent in man. Four is to encourage and promote the studies of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Five is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Six is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations of ages. Seven is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eight is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith, which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Nine is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained. There is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10 is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. I slowly speak the truth. To begin this evening's class, we will have a prayer by Dr. Carlos Thompson. Scripture lesson, Ephesians, the second chapter, to be read by Dr. Mary Cotton.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
May all bow our tonight. Giving Yahweh all praise, honor, and glory through His Son, Yahshua Messiah, who has allowed us to come to class, continue to learn of His purpose, His pattern, His plan. Hope that He will open up our hearts and minds to receive the things that will be presented to us tonight. And we know truly that Yahshua is the Comforter, He's the Holy Spirit. He's the one that has to bring all these things to our remembrance. And truly, it's all about His death, burial, resurrection, and high ascending, and outpouring His Holy Spirit to a man's heart and mind. We give Yahweh all praise, honor, and glory through His Son. Get an understanding of anything
through His Son, God's
Messiah. Hallelujah.
Good evening, class. This evening I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, containing the Holy Name versions of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late Navy Trainer, reprinted by Yahshua Productions 2012. Ephesians, the second chapter. And you have He quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, where in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our deportment in times past, in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But Yahweh, who is rich in mercy, for His great love wherewith He loved us, even when we were dead in sins, have quickened us together with the Messiah. By grace ye are saved. And have raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Yahshua Messiah. That in the ages to come He might show the exceeding riches of His grace and His kindness toward us through Yahshua Messiah. For grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of Yahweh. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are His workmanship, created in Yahshua Messiah, unto good works, which Yahweh hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Wherefore remember that ye, being in times past heathens in the flesh, who called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcisions in the flesh, made by hands. That at that time you were without the Messiah, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without Elohim in this world. But now is Yahshua the Messiah. Ye who formerly were far off are made nigh by the blood of the Messiah. For he is our peace, who have made both one and have broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that he might reconcile both unto Yahweh in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. And came and preached peace to you which were afar off, and to them that were not. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the sons, and of the household of Yahweh. And are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Yahshua Messiah himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth a holy temple unto Elohim, in whom ye also are built together for a habitation of Elohim through the Spirit. I've read Ephesians, the second chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
At this time, we would like to welcome our visiting brother, the intern dean of IDMR, Ontario, California class, Dr. Will Williams. We welcome you in the bonds of peace. It's an honor to call for our speaker this evening, Dr. Will Williams.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
First of all, I'd like to say it is indeed an honor and a pleasure to sup with the brethren here in Chattanooga and to learn more of this great and awesome, stupendous, colossal panoramic vision of Revelation given to us by Yahweh our Lord through one of our founder of this school. And it is a school, and it's not a church, and you want to learn something here. I was asked by Natalie to come by and visit Los Angeles today. But she asked specifically if I would go into the four plates. I do an exercise that Yahweh showed me many years ago that I developed for an 11-year-old girl. And basically, it's just what the founder laid out in his textbook. Okay. Just to go through, before we get into something substantial, I'd like to go through some predicates, if you will. You know, just to lead up to it, to why, how we understand this pattern and how to use it. I know on Tuesday nights, I almost feel kind of like at home, because on Tuesday nights is when I have my workshop there in Ontario class. And I like to say in the workshop that we want to deconstruct this vision, get down to its nuts and bolts, and see what makes it work, and then put it back together the way you found it, and run with it, okay? Now, basically, it starts off like this. This is an elementary chart. This is the first chart Dr. Kendrick drew when he sees this vision. The heart of this chart is the tabernacle pattern and the migratory. Okay? This is the heart of it, right here. Because Dr. Kelly delineated in our textbook, and see that heart cover right there? Yeah, just pass it to me. Well, thank you. Now I got to get my eyes. But on page, in volume one, page 126. Volume 1, page 126. This is this section here. See? This section is called The Number 7 Denotes Perfection. And in it, Dr. Kinley, he's delineating the seven steps of the tabernacle pattern, and he compares them to the seven steps of the migratory pattern. Okay? And he goes in. then explains each step and what it means. Okay? Now, this is basically what we're looking at. This is the heart of your understanding of correlations. Simply put, if you understand the seven correlations between the tabernacle pattern and the migratory pattern, then you understand these charts. Because the same correlations you're going to use here, you're going to use on all of them. It's really that simple. Okay? So let's just kind of just briefly do a little overview. Okay, thank you. Just a little overview here. Alright. Let me see if I can just move the camera.
I'm gonna help you out here.
We're gonna do this. This. Right. And if I'm right, my head should be about, head and shoulders should be about right here. If I'm right. Okay.
How you
look? How you look?
A bit more?
Alright. Okay. Alright. Here's the tabernacle pattern. Here's the migratory pattern. Okay? Let's just take it one step at a time. Alright? The first step is the gate. As the scripture says, all must enter into the straight gate. That gate is compared to the door of the Israelites' house down here in Egypt. Had to put the blood on the four points of blood. The top post, the lintel of the door, two side posts, and the base of the block. Which leads us to the second step of the tabernacle pattern, which is the brazen altar and sacrifice. With the four horns and where blood was put on it to match the four points of blood on the door of the Israelites' house. This is the second step. Alright? The third step is the brazen laver, right, where the priests and the animals were washed that. This is compared to the third step of the tabernacle, of the migratory tabernacle, the Red Sea. That's the third step, water and water. The fourth step in the pattern is the door, which is an opening. Compared to the migratory pattern, the Red Sea divided, making an opening, or door, which the Israelites crossed through. They were baptized and immersed in the cloud and in the sea, but they didn't get wet. Right. Now the fifth step is this whole holy place. There's a principle of 40 at the door. See? Why? Because, see, this tabernacle was 40 weeks in the construction. Just like here, the Israelites spent 40 years in the wilderness of Sinai. Okay? You can even make a comparison that a human being takes 40 weeks. For the construction of the human being, same way compared to the tablet. Okay? Took 40 weeks to build. The fifth step here consists of the golden lampstand, the golden table of shewbread, and the golden altar of incense. I like to just make it concise. Because see, you can elaborate as much as you want. For example, the seven branch lampstand was seven lamps on it, and it was all started from the middle pump. It poured oil in the middle prong, and it went out to the three prongs on the side, three on this side, three on that side, and it lit up the whole room. They lit this candlestick at 3 o'clock in the afternoon because it was a phenomenal cloud that the Israelites were being led by out here. There was a phenomenal cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. So this lamp was lit at 3 o'clock. And it burned for 18 hours until 9 o'clock in the morning. Because then the tabernacle, which is facing east, the sun would rise and see it would shine through the door and light the holy place. But I like I said, you can elaborate as much as you want, but I like to get it down to just brass tack principles. Light. That's the principle here, is light. Same way with the table of shewbread, I can say, well, there's 12 loaves of bread on here. Was a golden crown around it, see, and this was a daily sustenance for the high priest. But the principle I want to get out is simply is bread. That's the principle I want to get you. Same way with the golden altar of incense, see, this was where the high priest came and he knew the ingredients. There were four main ingredients, which is like the four ingredients of the atmosphere. The four ingredients was frankincense, onycha, stachy, and galbanum. See, and only the high priest knew how to mix them properly. All right? And it was a sweet smelling savor to Yahweh because of the stench of burnt flesh here. But the principle you should get out of this year is simply this: intercession. So in the holy place, we have light, bread, intercessor. We also have a principle of fort. Also, I'll mention something else too, because at the door is the spirit. Many instances, that principle will be manifested as an angel. Like here, you see the angel here. He's talking with Zacharias in this case, who's the father of John the Baptist. Okay, there's the angel here. But when you look in the holy place, in the migratory pattern, there was an angel there too. Remember, there was an angel in the cloud. Maybe we should read that. But some people don't believe that. I think that's Exodus 23 and 20. Just to emphasize the point.
Exodus 23 and 20. Behold, I sent an angel before thee to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into a place which I have prepared. Beware of him and obey his voice. Provoke him not, but he will not pardon your transgression. For my name is in him.
All right. See, now, there's an angel there. And you draw a line here. See, look here. There's an angel here with Noah. Because there's an angel showing Noah the specifications to the ark. There's an angel over here showing Adam and Eve the egress out of the Garden of Eden. So always look for that principle too. That comes up as well in certain cases of the story. An angel may appear there. Okay? Now we're in the holy place, as I said. That's light. Bread, light, bread, incense. We also tell you that there's a line, and see the scriptures tell you that. Maybe we should get that because Isaiah was his line upon line. So Isaiah 29. Yeah, I should read that. Because that's very important to understand that.
Isaiah
28:9.
Whom shall he teach knowledge?
Yes.
And whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breast.
Mm-hmm.
For precept must be upon precept.
Listen carefully. What is a precept? A precept is a principle. See? So a principle or a precept must be upon a precept. First you have to find out what the principle is. See, what are the characteristics of a principle? A principle doesn't change. It means that's immutable. A principle is perpetual. That means it goes on. It's eternal. A principle is irresistible. That means nothing can break it. It'll break you. Do you understand? Now, whatever you believe in doesn't follow those parameters, then chances are it's not a principle or a precept. The principles we talk about here, see, over here, see, we talk about there are three that bear record in heaven, 1 John 5:7. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. And these, there are three that bear witness in the earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one. Now, I just showed you one principle of these in the acid, which I picked with a little bit. But the principle here is the blood, the water, and the Spirit. Keep reading where you're at.
For a precept must be upon precept.
Uh-huh.
Precept upon precept.
Now, here's the precept of blood. See, this is a blood precept that goes throughout this particular part of the chart, and she's going to read it.
Not of the line.
It's a line. This is a blood line. Okay? This is water. That's a principle or a precept. This is a water line. See? This is a spirit, which is at the door of the fourth step. See? That's a line. It's a spirit line. See? And in the textbook, Dr. Kelly goes even a step further and says, when he talks about the most holy place, he says, that's a type of heaven. He even has it drawn out as a heaven line. This is a type of heaven. This is what you have to understand with the pattern. Understand where you're at. Bloodline, waterline, spirit line. In the holy place, the principles of light, bread, intercessor. Keep reading, please.
Line upon line.
Not one line upon the other. Here's a blood line. Here's a water line on top of that. Here's a spirit line on top of that. Okay, continue.
Here a little,
here a little, over to what Moses wrote, the first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Why? Because everything that the prophets have to say, for that matter, everything you have to say or what you want to show, you have to show where Moses talks about it. It's drawn out from what Moses wrote. Everything the prophets said is something, that's how they would check. They said, somebody would say something, and they said, okay, that sounds nice. Show me what Moses said there. Where are you getting that from? What are you basing your statement upon? That's what they would ask the prophets. And they would have to go into the law and say, well, the law says this. To try to show what they said, because everything is drawn out from what Moses said. The Messiah is fulfilling the law and the prophets. John on the Isle of Patmos is confirming not only Moses, but the prophets, as well as the Messiah, as well. Looks okay? All right, Moses here, the prophets is drawn out from that. Yahshua's fulfilling it. John is confirming. Our founder, Henry Clifford Kelly, said that he received this vision. He said it was not his purpose to dispute what Moses said, or the prophets said, or what Yahshua did, or what John the Baptist said, but to confirm what they said, because what he is showing is an encompassing everything that they did. You know, not to dispute with them, but to confirm what they were saying. Okay? Now, go back here. Now the fifth step, we even went through that, like I said. See, light, bread, incense. That's over here in the holy place of the wilderness of Sinai. It was a cloud by day, pillar of fire by night. It rained manna from heaven. They got bread. They had an intercessor. See, the Israelites saw Moses, but it was really Joshua, the son of Nun, because Joshua, we have it there, right here. See, this is the meeting tent of the congregation on the backside of the mount. Moses went in to speak to Joshua face to face, as a man speaking to a friend. He was the one that was intercessing for. And then when you get here to the Jordan River, Moses died. And it was Joshua that took over. 603,550 that came about in Egypt. Thank God. But it was a new birth that Joshua led over in the Canaan's land. And the Jordan River divided. Why? Come over here. See, here's the second departmental veil, blue, purple, and scarlet. This is the veil that separated the holy place from the most holy place. It is often called the veil of the flesh. That is typified over here by the Jordan River. Now the Jordan River divided. Why? Because it's showing you that the veil in the temple is going to be rent in twain when Yahshua's death. Because his physical body, come out Yahshua, represented the veil. So when he died, the veil in the temple rent in twain. Why? To show forth that now the holy place and the most holy place are now one. And then we have the most holy place, which is here, the Ark of the Covenant, with two archangels on top of the mercy seat. This is where the clouds sat. This is where the tables of stone that Moses brought up. This is the second tables of stone that Elohim wrote into his heart, because the first tables of stone, Moses broke. See, because of the Israelites' transgression, he was the golden calf. So he had to hew out another set of stones, and listen, the first tables of stones was cut out of the mountain, and Elohim wrote on it. The second tables of stone Moses had to fit in that indentation, and Elohim would write again. This is the table of stones that's put into the Ark of the Covenant. Also in the Ark of the Covenant, you have Aaron's rod that went into Aaron. You also have a pot of manna as well. And this is the seat of authority. See, because this is where Yahweh Elohim governed the whole body of Israel from. That's reflected here in the most holy place of the migratory tree. Here you have David. See, Elohim moved his hand off on David's body. And that in turn gave David the specifications to pass to Solomon on how to build this temple. This temple was also threefold. It was a porch, a sanctuary, and an oracle. And it was in ascending order on Mount Moriah. At the top was a golden dome on top. A dome made of beaten gold that reflected the light, you know, from the sun and even the light of the moon. On the full moon, at a distance, it would look like a beacon. It would be be like a flash of light. Why? Because, see, that would be like the flash of the Shekinah on the Day of Atonement. And see, and when they looked at this temple, it looked like a man sitting on the throne, because when you came to the porch, you had to pass through two giant chapiters, giant brass chapiters that looked like legs. You know, they even had names. One of the chapiters' name was Boaz. The other one was called Jachin. See, and then you go through the porch, going up, ascending up into the next level, which would be the sanctuary. And then you would ascend up into the next level, which is the Ark, where the Ark of the Covenant was placed at, where this throne of gold was at. Okay? Now that's just a brief comparison between the migratory tract, and the tabernacle pattern, showing the seven steps. And that's what Dr. Kelly outlines in this textbook. And as I said, if you know those seven correlations, it's the same correlations you're going to use on all of them. It's the same, it has to be the same, because the template is the same. It's the tabernacle pattern. It's Yahweh Elohim. And really what you're doing, Dr. Kinley, when he was a holiness preacher for 15 years, right? Bibliomaniac from what I understood. But when he received this vision and revelation, even he had to admit, he said, look, the Bible just don't read the same anymore. Why? Because he's looking at it through the eyes of the pattern. He's looking at it through the eyes of the author. And that's what you will be doing. You will be looking at the scriptures through the eyes of the author. Everybody reads the Bible. It's the most widely read book on the planet. It's like hundreds of versions written in, or at least over 2,000 languages. I mean, it's the world's bestseller ever since Johann Gutenberg printed it 500 years ago. But here's another distinction it has. It's the least understood book on the planet. Why? Everybody has an opinion on it. Were it not so, they wouldn't make this Encyclopedia of American Religion, because half of that stuff comes from the Bible. Well, a lot of these concepts that these people have. See? But what we're going to do, we're going to look at it through the eyes of the author, through the eyes of Yahweh Elohim, who is the original archetype pattern of the universe. Okay? Now, something else I need to get to help us on our way. I need Jacob's ladder. That's in Genesis, I think it's either 28th or 29th chapter, somewhere around Jacob's ladder.
Let's look at the ladder. We told you there's seven steps in here. It
look at each step like a rung on a ladder. The gate would be the first rung. Altar, sin, and sacrifice, second rung. Brazen labor, third rung. The door, the fourth rung. The holy place, the fifth rung. The second apartment of Baal, the sixth rung. The Ark of the Covenant, the seventh rung. Seven rungs on a ladder. Get it like you're climbing up on a ladder. Up and down on a ladder. Ascending and descending. Okay? It's the same way here. This is a migratory church. There are principles of ascending and descending on there. Some will do descending, for example, here. This is the Garden of Eden. This is the Adamic, this is the Edenic transgression. This is a descending place. Why? Because the story starts here. So I'm going to start here with the story and then look at it coming on down, descending to here. Now, if I come over here to Noah, this is an ascending place. Why? Because Noah wanting the wicked happened before the flood, before the ark resting between the mountains of Ararat. So this is an ascending place that starts here. This place, migratory track, it does both. Because see, Abraham was shown Canaan's land, and he walked the length and breadth of Canaan's land and never set foot on the promised land. However, he was told that his seed would inherit this land. But first they had to go down to a land they knew not to be subjected to bondage, but they would come out with great substance and claim their inheritance. It's a round trip, descending and ascending. You will find some place that may do that as well. The key is simply to read the scriptures. The scriptures will tell you how it's going, and you're looking at it using the tabernacle pattern, using the steps and the precepts of the pattern, okay? I think there's nothing to bring up. Okay, that's basically it as far as the preliminaries, okay? Now, it's just a matter of just picking a plate, so to speak. We could come over here, because I like the colors better. Yeah, just pick it up. And as I tell them, I'm just coming this way. I know, I'm known as the great director back home. No, you can come closer, come on up here. Yeah, just come on up here. Come on. And we'll just make, can I help you make the adjustment? All right. All right. I think that'll work. Okay. All right. I'm going to something I've been kind of going into lately. And that's cosmology. All right, look, am I here and everything's good. All right. This is cosmology. This is it simply means the origin of the universe. Okay? Now, I always say this, to understand this plate, you really have to understand this plate. This is theosophy. You have to understand how Elohim comes into being. See, to understand that, let's start with this. Romans 1:19 and 12.
Romans
1:19
and 20. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them. For Yahweh has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
Okay, so it takes the natural things to understand the spiritual things, right? Even his supernal nature, what we say is Godhead. Some people say the Yahweh. I think Dr. Kennedy says that. And also his eternal power. Now, what is his eternal power? His eternal power is the power of transmutation. That is to say, to change from one state to another. We say it often enough. Matter is spirit materialized. How did it come up? How did it come that way? By transmutation. Okay? So you have to understand, now to understand how matter is transmuted into a state, you have to understand how Yahweh Elohim is made manifest into the state. Because, for example, Dr. Kinley writes in the first, in volume one of his textbook, he writes about the hydrogen atom. The way he says it is like this. He calls it the 92nd atom. Now, any chemist will tell you the 92nd atom on the periodic table of elements is uranium. But what he is describing, his definition is simply this. All the other elements are threefold, a proton, a neutron, and an electron. All right? But the hydrogen atom appears to be just a proton and an electron. And so someone would say, well, what happened? Where's the missing part? You know, your God messed up or something. You know, he forgot about that one. No, that's drawn out as a specialty. Why? Because it's trying to show you that it's created in the image and likeness of Elohim. Okay? Exodus 24, 9 and 10.
Uh-huh. And they saw the government of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Now I said there was under his feet, as it were, the paved work of a sapphire stone. So, okay, well, what is that sapphire stone? If you don't know what it is, then you'll have to find out. Isaiah 66 and 1. Remember the law and the prophets. The prophets is drawing out from what Moses wrote. So now we're going to find out what Isaiah wrote about this when he read Moses. This is what he said.
Thus said Yahweh, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool.
And the earth is my footstool. That's the clarification. That's the paved work of a sapphire stone that Elohim is standing on. He is standing on the earth. And that makes Elohim the original hydrogen atom. How so? He himself would be like the proton, and the paved work of a sapphire stone would be like the electron. But he is immersed in the cloud, which is the invisible third part. See? That's Elohim. That's the hydrogen, that's the original hydrogen atom, if I can put it like that. Because look, when Elohim comes forth here, see here, up here it says inscrutable, incomprehensible. That's on the cloud. When he's coming out from the cloud, in principle, he's coming from behind a veil. He's coming through a veil. The cloud is darkness, not darkness, but it's abstract. You can't see it. So him coming out from behind the veil would be like the light shining out of the darkness. He's coming from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility into an organized state. Now here is the attributes. See, this is what he really is. This is how he appears to man, because this is what man can relate to. But this is what he really is, an organized set of attributes. And when Elohim first began to take on shape and form, it was intelligence that came first. Dr. Kinley explains it in one of his transcripts. He calls it the crown. Intelligence is flanked by wisdom and knowledge. See, and together they make up a triad. That makes up what is called supreme crown. Now what Dr. Kinley did was this. Just draw a line. Just draw a line. And we come over here to the high priest here. The high priest wore a bonnet that said holiness to Yahweh. He had straps on that bonnet. That would be like this. The holiness to Yahweh would be like wisdom. And then the straps would be like intelligence. Intelligence, and then the straps will be like wisdom and knowledge. See, the crown on top of his head. That's why Dr. Kinley called those. See, he called this set of attributes supreme crown because they control the other attributes, just like your brain or your nervous system controls the rest of your body. In fact, you came in the same way. As you came in the same way as Elohim did, because it started off like this, and then these attributes emanated or produced another set of attributes, which is beauty, flanked by love and justice, And they in turn produce the next set of attributes, which is foundation, flanked by power and strength, and all nine of them are embedded in the 10th attribute, which is the kingdom. Just like your nine systems of your body are embedded in the 10th system of your body, the integumentary system, which is your skin. See, by a black boy. You may have to pick it up and say, yeah, don't be afraid, just, there you go. Like, until it gets, don't too, not too far back, because I want people to see this. All right. So you started off as an unfertilized egg, an ovum, okay? And then we got a sperm coming here, and you know, he ain't the only one, he's got like 60 million of them, you know, that's surrounding this egg. And then only one is allowed to break through, all right, and fertilizes the egg, all right? The tail breaks off and the egg is fertilized. But even when it's fertilized at still a particular juncture, it's still considered one cell. Now that it's fertilized, it becomes a zygote. Then it begins to go through a process of cell division. That is called mitosis. One cell becomes two, two becomes four, four becomes 16, so forth and so on, and trillions of cells later, voila, there you are. But you started off as one cell. Now you can come back. Here, this heart, which is Elohim, is in all the top of this. This is him, all right? Now, here on cosmogony, you have on the veil, this is a veil. Let me say something about the veils, because my humble opinion, a lot of people don't understand the veils. The veils represent points of transition. Anytime you cross a veil, there has to be a transition. I'll give you an example. Let's take H2O for example. H2O, I hope everybody knows what it is, but everybody here knows what H2O is? Good. H2O in excess of 212 degrees Fahrenheit is a gas, or steam, or vapor. That would be in the most holy place. Now, if it cools lower than 212 degrees, 212 degrees in principle is a veil. When H2O cools past 212 degrees, it makes a transition, crossing the veil, and it becomes a liquid. It becomes water. Now, there's another veil, the first departmental veil. If it crosses that veil, it has to make another transition. It transitions from liquid to ice or solid, okay? But it's still H2O in all of its states. Likewise, you put it in a pot, warm it up, past 32 degrees, it crosses a veil or makes a transition back into liquid or water. Keep heating it up. Once it gets past 212 degrees, it crosses another veil. It makes another transition. It changes from water to steam, but it's still H2O. You get it? But by crossing the veils, it has to make a transition. Another principle of the veil, the second departmental veil, the way Dr. Kinley explains it is that the veils also represent the concealing and the revealing. Here, the third day. Maybe we can read that out of the textbook, maybe. It's the third day, I don't want to read the whole thing, I just want to read this one little excerpt here. It's, yeah, follow the action. That's right. I shall teach you to be a videographer. Yeah. It's a third day in the first line. Volume one, third day. Page 62, the last paragraph, which is the second veil.
Plate number eight?
Mm-hmm.
Plate number eight?
No. It's page 62, the third paragraph.
Page 62.
Third paragraph, second veil, says the second veil, plate 1B.
Yes.
The
second veil, plate 1B, dividing the holy place from the most holy place, symbolizes the bud, concealing and thereafter revealing the division between blossom and fruition.
Now, if you look on there on that page, you'll see Dr. Kinley has those words, concealing and revealing, underlined. Does he not? See, I can see it on there, see. This is right here. I'll show you. See that? Right? He's got the underline to show you the importance of that veil. That is for the concealing and revealing. That's the principle of the second departmental veil. Because Yahshua, when he died on the cross here, the veil in the temple rent in twain. Why? Because it was concealed. Anybody couldn't go up into the most holy place. Only the high priest could do that. And on the Day of Atonement only, and only in a certain way. Everybody would have to be outside the tabernacle because he had bells and pomegranates on the head of his garment. They could hear the bells when he's officiating, and if the bells ever stopped ringing for some reason, they was like, uh-oh, something went wrong here. He had messed up. He did something wrong, or he touched the Ark of the Covenant when he wasn't supposed to. And we ain't going up in there, you know, unless Yahweh break forth on us. Fellas, go get the meat hooks, you know, and they be up under that veil trying to feel him out, you know, that kind of thing. But the point I'm making is, on this plane, this is what we're talking about. This is the division between spirit and matter. And we got angels on here. That represents the angelic creation. Okay? So now here's this heart coming through the veil. In part, it did not take all of Yahweh Elohim to transmute into one hydrogen atom. And then Yahweh couldn't tell it no more than he told the other atom down here. Be fruitful and multiply. What do you mean? Going a little too fast. What do you mean? One atom became two. Two became four. Four became, and so forth and so on until here, when we got, as Dr. Kelly describes it, a great amalgamated conglomeration of a coring mass. In other words, this is what the galaxy, this is tame compared to how massive this really was, because out of this, you got galaxies and whatnot coming out of here. You know, galaxies are full of billions of stars, and they're billions of galaxies. So that should tell you how massive this thing was. But it started off with one little hydrogen atom, which is how you started off, as one cell. And trillions of cells later, you are. One hydrogen atom, and then what? Whoa! Trillions and trillions of atoms later, what do you got? A universe out of it. Galaxies, and black holes, and comets, and nebulas, and so forth and so on. But it started with one atom. See, and then coming through the, see, that's, it's just, it's a process, and we're descending. Because this is Elohim, going through the veils, transmuting in part into this hydrogen atom. Every time you go through a veil, there's a transition. Here it is, transitioning into, now, this great amalgamation, conglomeration of a coring mass. This is which everything is created out of. See? Now, that's just showing that one thing on how the creation come in. But now we could just go through any of these plates and just, somebody pick a plate. Pick a plate, somebody. What do you want to talk about there? Carboniferous face of the deep, and that's a veil. Okay? let's get Psalms 18 and 11. I think that's what. Now, before you get there, let's just read Genesis 1 and 1. Let's read that first. And then we'll get Psalms.
Genesis 1 and 1. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
Uh-huh.
And the earth was without form and void.
Uh-huh.
And darkness was upon the face of the deep.
Here it is. Here's the darkness. Upon the face of the darkness on the face of the deep. And the darkness is a veil. You can't see nothing, right? See, but we know that there's something behind this darkness. There's the spirit law, but it's behind the veil. You can't see it, but read.
And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the water.
Now here's the spirit of Elohim moving upon the face of the waters. See? And he's that original cosmic light. See, because the scientists will say, well, how did the plants go? Because we have here the plants growing on the third day, but the next day, the sun is put in the sky. And the scientists say, well, how can that be? Because plants need light to grow. Well, it was because of the cosmic light of Yahweh Elohim. See, the true sun, as opposed to the S-O-N, the S-U-N, rather. But keep reading.
And Elohim said, let there be light.
Let there be light.
And there was light.
And there was, he was that light. He was that light, see? And see, he's the light that moved across the face of the deep, the chaoses. See, the light shining out of the darkness, coming through the veil. See, the light shining out of the darkness. All right, and then he goes through the days of creation. Go ahead.
And Elohim saw the light, that it was good.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim divided the light from the darkness.
And he divided the light from the darkness. Okay, read.
And Elohim called the light day,
uh-huh.
And the darkness he called night.
Mm-hmm.
And the evening and the morning were the first day.
Okay, the evening and the morning were the first day. Now, let's just put this in perspective. This is not the actual creation, because the actual creation came in quicker than that. But this is broken down for Moses' sake, because this is Moses who writes this in the Genesis as Elohim is showing it to him when he's in the mount. See, and see, here's another thing. When Elohim created the creation, he didn't have to say anything. He just did it. He just willed it and it happened. But here we hear him speaking. Why? He's doing that for Moses' sake, because Moses is in the cloud. See, and Joshua son of Nun is transfigured before him. It's really Joshua son of Nun who transfigured in front of Moses as Elohim, and Elohim transforming into each aspect of the creation. That's this part here. Transmuting, coming through the veil, transmuting into every different part of the creation. Now get Psalms 18 and 11, because I want to go back to this chaos here for just one, right quick.
Psalms
18
and 11.
Uh-huh.
He made darkness his secret place.
Why is David saying that? He's drawing out from what we just read in Genesis. You understand? This is the secret, because darkness is a veil. It's his secret hiding place. Read.
His pavilion round about him were dark waters and thick clouds the above the sky.
What's a pavilion? That's something on the outside, like a court on the outside. The earth, remember the earth is his footstool. Where is that? That's the court around about, the pavilion. So here's this pavilion here, was surrounded with water, and it was in darkness. But he's there in the darkness. You just can't, he's covered, he's hidden, until the light shines out of that darkness. You see what I'm saying? It's a veil. But even in the darkness, he's there. See, it's not like, oh, nobody's here. I don't see nothing. He's just hidden behind a veil. Continue.
And at the brightest day was before him, his thick clouds passed.
Uh-huh.
Hailstones and coals were fire.
Ah.
Yahweh also thundered in the heavens.
He thundered it in, see? Why did he say that? Because that's how he did it for Moses. We just read it, and Elohim said. Elohim is saying that for Moses, so Moses can follow along. But David, who's drawing out from what Moses wrote, he's got to echo that. Oh, he thundered in the creation. Why? Because we're reading it. And Elohim said this, and then he thundered it in. John confirms it when he's talking about, I heard seven thunders. And he was getting ready to write about it. Elliot said, no, that's all right. Don't write about it. I got Moses taking care of it. It's okay. Moses got that. You don't have to do that. But you can't, but that's okay if you write about the seven thunders, because you're confirming that Moses did write that. And we just read that David is, he's one of the prophets too. The Psalms is part of the prophecy or the testimony as well. It's because he's drawing out from what Moses wrote. Okay? Is there anything else there?
And the highest gave his voice. Oh yeah, that's it.
Okay. Now, that's the chaos, see? The light shining out of darkness. See, it's a reflection of what happened here when Elohim comes forth. Coming out from the cloud. The light shining out of darkness. Because the cloud is abstract. You can't perceive it. You can't say it. Dr. Kelly said it like this. He said, the human mind cannot conceive what it cannot perceive. Since you cannot perceive the pure spirit state of Yahweh, then you can conceive nothing about it. It's a blank to you until Elohim steps forward. The light shining out of the darkness. It's no different for you today, because you come in here, you didn't know a damn thing. None of us did. We were ignorant. Until the light shined out of the darkness. John 1 and 1.
John 1 and 1. In the beginning was the Word.
Uh-huh.
And the Word was without form and void.
That's the wrong word.
In the beginning was the Word.
Uh-huh.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
Right.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
Uh-huh.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
Uh-huh.
All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life. And the light was the light of men.
And the light was the light of men. Read.
And the light shineth in darkness.
Go ahead.
And the darkness comprehended it not.
See, the light was there in you all along, but your darkness or your ignorance, you didn't comprehend that Yahweh Elohim was in you. You thought it was Jesus or Muhammad or whoever. But you didn't realize that till you came here, and the light, when the gospel was preached, then the light shone out. I mean, then you understood the light shining out of the darkness of your ignorance. See, that's the principle that you're looking. All of these things represent principles and precepts. Once you understand what the precepts and the principles are, the manifestations will be nothing, because the principles will shine through. As we always say, the manifestation will change, but the principle will always remain the same. Okay? And that's what you have to understand. Once you understand what the precepts or the principles are, then you'll be able to recognize them through the manifestations. Okay? Let's go back to Genesis, since she wants to hear about the creation. We'll just kind of walk through it a little bit.
6. And Elohim said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the water.
Uh-huh.
And let it divide the waters from the waters.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament.
Mm-hmm.
And it was so.
Okay.
And,
now, here's the second day. Now, we got up here. The firmament says, the firmament called heaven. Now, maybe we should read something. 2 Corinthians 12 and 1.
Paul
says he was caught up to the third heaven. Now, there's a third heaven that would preclude there's a first and a second, right? Now, we just read about the second heaven. See, it says the firmament called heaven. That would be the second heaven. Now, the first heaven is space, right? And if you look on the Moses chart, you look down in Egypt, you see that it's black. It's mostly covered black down there. Why? Because space is black. The earth hangs like a ball in space. The earth would be like this altar of sin and sacrifice. Because when you look on a map, on a geography map, there are lines on the earth. You have lines of latitude, you have lines of longitude. It looks like a grate. See, why? Because that's what was happening here. See, and they always talk about the four corners of the earth, even though it's a spheroid. But that would be like this golden altar of sin and sacrifice. Then you got the brazen laver here. That would be like the oceans of the world. And then you have the atmosphere that surrounds the earth. That would be the second heaven. Or the firmament, as we read in the scriptures. And then you have the third heaven. The third heaven is not geographical. That's a state or a condition. The first two heavens are. The first heaven is space. The second heaven is the atmosphere. Those two heavens emanate from the third. Okay? Now over here, the second day of creation. Here we have the waters above the firmament. And then we have the waters beneath. And see it now, in time, when you begin to do correlations with these plates, not only will you be able to take the tabernacle pattern and the migratory pattern and compare each plate with, if you understand the principles of the pattern, you can compare one plate with another. Okay? Like, for example, let me see, in this case. All right, we'll say this. This plate here, second day, we can compare to this plate here, which is the flood. Because here, let's see up here, you have the waters above, see, which is behind the veil, and then you have the waters beneath, which is also under a veil. See, it says, this first veil, it says the division between the waters beneath. So here's the division between the waters beneath and the division between the waters above and a firmament in the midst. The firmament is the atmosphere. The word firmament means a vault or an arch or a support, okay? That's the firmament. Now, here, now you can take, now you've got waters above and waters beneath. Get Genesis 7 and 11.
Genesis 7 and 11.
Mm-hmm.
In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up.
Now here's the fountains of the deep. They were, both of them, by veil. But now compare that to this plate here, the flood, plate 19. See, now read that again, that line again.
In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day when all the fountains of the great deep broken up.
Now the fountains of the deep broken up. That's the reading of a veil here, the first department of veil, from below. Read.
And the windows of heaven were open.
And the windows of heaven were open. That's the second department of veil. Opened up, and if, in other words, see, the waters above and the waters beneath, the stop gaps were open, and they just came together in the middle. And the only thing that survived was the ark and those eight souls that was in it. The rest of the human race you see here, they couldn't handle that. There were people that built their own boats, but their boat was not, but it was without divine specifications and without divine instructions. That's why they sunk. And don't you think that people, that there were people, Noah preached 120 years. There were people that helped Noah build that ark. And they got the time, you know, they were waiting on the rain, because it didn't rain in that age. And so they're like, you know, they believed at first, you know, but then after a time, Jesus said, well, you know, Noah, man, I don't know about this, man. I'm later for this. And it just came down to Noah and his family. But when they felt that first raindrop, the first place they went to was to that door of the ark. Noah, let me in, let me in. But Noah didn't close that, didn't, you know, he didn't close that door. So he couldn't open it. You know? And I mean, you can imagine, oh man, no, man, let me in, man, I helped cut the wood down, man, don't that count for something? But it's too late. See? But here it is. The windows of heaven were open and the fountains of the deep were broken. And it just came together like that. See? Now, if you understand that, let's just draw a line. Down to here, this is eschatology. Now, I was told that Yahweh said he put a bow in the sky because he said he wasn't going to destroy the earth again by water. He didn't say anything about fire. But it's the same principle. The windows of heaven will be broken open and the fountains of the deep will be broken open. Instead of water, it's fire. Fire from above, fire from below. And guess who gets caught in the middle? It's the same principle. Just like the flood. It has to be the same way because it's by the pattern. Yahweh ain't changing up on them. They say, okay, I'm going to do it this way, one way. And then down the line, they'll change up and do it another way. No, it don't work like that. It's according to a divine pattern. So it's the same thing in principle here with eschatology. The windows of heaven be broken open, the fountains of the deep be broken open. Fire from above and fire from below. Caught in the middle. Not literal fire, but it's the principle. You understand what I'm saying? See, it's the same thing, the principle. Okay? Now, let's go back to Genesis, where we at? I think you were in the third day.
Seven,
wherever you left off at?
One and seven. And Yahweh made the firmament and divided the waters, which were under the firmament, from the waters which was above the firmament, and it was so.
And it was so.
And Elohim said, and Elohim called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. And Elohim said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto one place. And let the dry land appear, and it was so.
And let the dry land appear. And it was, in other words, the waters had to roll back. And the dry land appeared, and then the seed of vegetation appeared. This is why I said, when you understand the Antediluvian age, the earth was one landmass. At that time, they were not the seven continents that we know them to be. That didn't happen until the flood, when the fountains of the deep broke open and pushed them apart. There's evidence of that if you get a good geology book. You can see, like, the map of the ocean floor. There's a ridge that, you know, that stretches around the planet. And the continents are on plates. And they move. And they know that at one time, all these land masses was one. But see, but they're talking about, well, this happened 300 million years ago. And I'm like, and I'm saying, look, it don't take Yahweh 300 million years to break up a landmass, you know, to do anything for that matter. It don't take Yahweh that long, okay? But now here we got the waters rolling back and the seed of vegetation appeared, okay? Now see, you can take that and you can compare that to the migratory trek. Because here you got Israel down here, who's the seed of Abraham. And then what happened? When they got to the Red Sea, the waters rolled back, and then they went through on dry land, the seed of Israel. The seed appeared in the holy place. You see, it's the same, you're just using the same principles here. Okay, keep going when you're reading.
10. And Elohim called the dry land earth, and gathered together the waters called
his
seeds. And Elohim saw that it was good.
Read.
And Elohim said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself, upon the earth, and it was so. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind. And Elohim saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning was the third day.
Okay, now, here we got here. It says the first veil, the gathering together of the waters. That's a veil, see, separating the waters. In other words, so the dry land, and the dry land appeared. In other words, the waters were, and the dry land appeared. That's like a death, a burial, a resurrection. Because then you got fruit appeared. It's an ascension. And we read that in the textbook about the division between the blossom and fruition. That's the veil principle. Just like a tulip. A tulip will be in a bulb position. It's being, as in other words, the flower is concealed. But at the right time, it will sprout open to reveal what is within the veils. Okay? Keep reading.
14. And Elohim said, let there be lights in the firmament of heavens to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years.
I see the sun in the sky, the sun to rule the day, we're going to say, and the stars and the moon. We'll keep reading.
And let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And Elohim made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. And Elohim set them in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth.
All right, now, he set them that way, and he made the stars. Now, look the way Dr. Kelly has it drawn here. All right, he says, now the stars in the firmament, and they're on the veil. All right, let's just draw a line. See, that would be like the angels here on this veil. That's what the stars represent. They're a type of the angels. All right, go back here. Now, Dr. Kinley on here highlighted this planet here, the planet Saturn. Why? Because the planet Saturn is a very bright object in the sky, and it's also the planet that has rings around it. The rings, so you go around the planet. Now the rings represent, Saturn itself represents Satan and his doctrine. Because what his doctrine does is heads you in. You know, it circumscribes you. If I can put it like that's the way Dr. Kelly put it. By putting you in. And see, these are veils. If you don't know anything, let's say if you don't know anything, see, the sun is the object that rules the day, and the moon is the object that rules the night. Now, if you're in ignorance, that means you're in night. That means you're being ruled by the moon. And see, the moon represents cardinal ordinances. Not just only the 613 cardinal ordinances that was given to the Israelites, but any cardinal ordinance. Because the Gentiles did by nature what the Jews had to do by law. So if they're doing cardinal ordinances, then the Gentiles, they're in the night, and they're being ruled by the moon. Jeremiah 31
and 35. Thus said Yahweh, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinance of the moon and of the stars for a light by night.
Now why is Jeremiah saying that? Because he read what we just read, and he understands that the moon represents the cardinal ordinances. Also, these were for signs and for seasons. This is where we get our calendar from. The Hebrew calendar is based on the movement of the moon. The moon makes one revolution around the earth every 29 and a half days. And it does this 12 times in a solar year. So when you multiply that, that means that there's 354 days in a lunar year. The lunar year is 354 days. Now a solar year is 365 and a quarter days, right? Because every 4 years, we have to add a year on for leap year. That's a solar year, the movement of the sun. So now, the world, if they're in darkness, then they're being ruled by the moon, the ordinances of the moon. That is to say, whatever cardinal ordinance you happen to think of, this is what you're being ruled by. You're in the dark. Well, if you're in the dark, what are you going to see? The moon and the star. But by the same token, it's a principle. Because if you are at night and all you see is the moon and the stars, it also means that that's also pointing out the law and the prophets. Because Yahshua the Messiah is the sun. What is that at? I think it's 1 Peter 1:19. Or 2 Peter 1:19.
2 Peter 1:19.
Mm-hmm.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy.
Mm-hmm.
Whereunto you do well.
We have also a more sure word of prophecy,
mm-hmm.
Whereunto ye do well, that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place, mm-hmm. until the day dawn.
Until the day dawn. What? Well, if the day got it dawn, where was you at before then? You were night. You were night, yeah. Right? Till the day dawn, until Yahshua, who is the S-O-M, of which the S-U-M is a reflection of, rise in your heart and mind. See, until the day dawn, see? Read.
And the day star arise in your heart.
And the day, which is the sun, which rules the day or the light. Get it? Is there anything else there?
Knowing this verse, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation.
See, now this is no private interpretation. This is according to a divine pattern, what we're going through here. See, this is not my terms of, well, that's what you say. No, this is what the pattern says. And I can look at it and see. Till the day dawn rise in your heart. But look, where is it at? Here he is, here. Here's Yahshua. See? He's the day star that rises. See? And look, here's the S-U-N on Sunday morning. They're both rising together. Why? Because when you look back here, yeah, here's Adam here. He's being cast out. The sun is going down. Both suns are going down together. So if that be the case, then you have to see over here both suns rising together. And then it goes even further. The moon is under her feet, because it talks about a woman clothed in the sun. And the moon, under her, well, see, if she's clothed in the sun up here, then the moon would be under her feet. Because here's where the moon is, right here. See? Clothed in the sun and the moon under her feet. In other words, now you're not subject to the moon. Because you're in the light, as we just said, the day dawn in your heart and mind. Now you're not subject to the light of the moon no more. Yeah, I get it. But I'm just trying to show that, hey, everything, it's all on here. It's all on here because, see, you can go, oh my goodness, we're just getting started. We're just cracking the egg here. Because when you really start getting into this, these charts, not just this will also lead you to the other chart. All of these charts are integrated and they correlate with each other. And you have to put them together like pieces of a puzzle. So that you can see the bigger picture in here. These are just pictorial illustrations, two-dimensional. Dr. Kennedy said not the best artistry, but enough to convey a precept, enough to convey a principle, enough for you to look at and begin to understand in here the greater glory of what this is trying to portend or portray. See? And we got the seasons of the year, fall, winter, spring, see, death, burial, spring, resurrection, summer, ascension, okay? We have all of that principles here, and see, and this Elohim, this heart, he's the one that's manifesting in part, not in totality, see? So you're making all of this to happen. Okay, let's continue reading Genesis
17. And Elohim set them in the firmness of the heaven, mm-hmm. to give light upon the earth, and to rule over the day and over the night.
Over the night.
And to divide the light from the darkness.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim saw that it was good.
Read.
And the evening and the morning were the fourth day.
Continue.
And Elohim said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that had life, and fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament, mm-hmm. of the heaven. And Elohim created great whales and every living creature that moved, with which the waters brought forth abundantly after their kind, and every winged fowl after his kind.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim saw that it was good. And Elohim blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let fowl multiply in the earth. And the evening and the morning was the fifth day.
Okay. Now, let's just look at this. Spirit law still operating. Now, here we got here, we have the formation of insects. All right, their formation, and they're in a dead-like state. Because they're not animated yet. Okay? So that's a death. And the biological formation, see, It says coming out from the waters. It did say that from the waters, right? So that's a burial. It says death and a burial. And then here we got the spirit animating these things. So that's a death, burial, resurrection. Okay? And that brings you in here. The division between inanimate and animate. What do you, well, why is there a division between? Because at the veil, look, at the veil, here is where the cup of holy anointing is. That was the fourth quickening. That's at the door. That's, and that takes, and that's in the holy place. Not out here, but here. See, you, at the door, and that's a quickening here to make you operate in here. Why? Because that's what he says here. You're crossing a veil. The division between inanimate and animate. So now they're quickened. And now they're animated. Okay, here. And then here we got the ornithological and biological king. Ornithological, that deals with the birds. And the birds here are pictured on the veil. So the birds are a type of angels because they fly through the sky. See, they're both a type of angels and demons. See, they're on the veil. Draw a line. Here's the angels on the veil. See, and there are demons on it too. They were cast out. And see, because you have birds that will eat seeds and fruits and stuff, but you have birds that will eat other birds that are carnivorous. You know, they'll attack, and, you know, and that would be like demons. See, like that. So you have both good and bad, so to speak. You know, you have the carnivorous birds, and then you have the, what's the other ones?
Huh?
Yeah, that's the word I was thinking. Herbivores, right. See, those that will, you know, yeah. And then you have birds that are bound to the water, like penguins. They can't fly, so they're bound to the water. You have other birds that are bound to the land that can't fly, like ostriches. They can't fly. They can run, but they can't fly. Why? They're bound to the land. Why? They're tight. It's showing you a type of, when Satan and his host was cast out, as he was there. When Satan and his host here was cast out of heaven, they were bound to the earth. This is the bottom of this picture. This is the first heaven. So they're bound here. See, they're not only here, but also the second heaven as well, because it does say that Satan is the prince of the power of the air. That's the second heaven. But see, he can't get past that. Here's the way Dr. Kennedy showed it. Once, and I really appreciate it because it's really simple. This is the way he did it. He did it like this. You drew a tabernacle on the board. Okay. You just drew a tabernacle like that. Most holy place, court around God. Satan was up here and he got cast out. So he got cast out here to the bottomless pit. But he keeps trying to get back in, but he can't because there's a veil here. So he's rebuffed back. You see what I mean? Now, I think that's pretty simple, ain't it? See, to show you what he is. See, he got cast out. Now he's trying to come back, but he can't get back here because there's a veil here. So he's rebuffed. He comes back down. And that's what he is, a six. See? So that's the principles you want to see here, all right? You want to see, you know, comparing with the pattern, okay? Let's keep reading.
24. And Elohim said, let the earth bring forth a living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping things, and beasts of the earth after his kind.
After their kind, so that knocks out evolution. But that's what people say, you know, we primates, so to speak, we evolved from apes. Another thing the evolutionists say, they say that the birds evolved from the dinosaurs. That's what they say, see. But that can't be, because if that be the case, then there should be some throwback among the bird kingdom, like some birds, you know, because they used to be, they have bones of flying lizards. You know, they call them pterodactyls, pteranodons, that kind of thing. Well, a bird should have two birds, you know, they should have a throwback, a flying lizard or something, you know. Two birds having a lizard. If you're saying that they evolved from the dinosaurs, then there should be a throwback among the birds. And I don't see that happening. See, just like when they say the man evolved from the apes, well, the two people should all, there should be a throwback somewhere if the genetic material is there for us being an ape, even though they'll say, well, they have some of the same chromosomes we do and all that, with the exception of a couple, you know, that makes a difference. And let me tell you, those chromosomes that they don't have, that we have, do make a difference, okay? Because there ain't gonna be a way where an ape is gonna evolve to the level of a man. Sure, they've had things where they've taught an ape how to do sign language and stuff like that, you're not gonna see nothing like Planet of the Apes. You know, like that guy Caesar, that ape Caesar, they're gonna form an army, they be riding horseback and shooting guns and all. That ain't gonna happen, okay? I mean, it's nice festival fiction, you know, that kind of thing, but that's not gonna happen, okay? Keep reading.
And beasts of the earth after his kind, and it was so.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim made the beasts of the earth after his kind, and cattle after their kind,
mm-hmm.
and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim said that it was good.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea,
mm-hmm.
and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So Elohim created man in his own image. In the image of Elohim created he him.
Mm-hmm.
Male and female created he them.
Okay.
And Elohim blessed them. And Elohim said unto them, be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish, over the of the sea,
mm-hmm.
and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth.
Okay, now, this represents Moses' second trip in the mountain, the first time he sees the vision. And so when Moses sees this, and he comes back down after 40 days, because he sees this, and he sees the tabernacle. And he comes back down to the 70 elders, because he's been gone for 40 days. And they were like, oh, Moses, where you been, man? We saw you go up into this fiery inferno and lightning and thunder and earthquake. We thought you were gone. I said, no. And so what happened to you? And then Moses just starts saying, well, in the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And he goes on at what we just read in the first chapter. Now, mind you, Joshua, the son of Nun, who took Moses up and showed him this, is listening to Moses tell this to the 70 elders. And he realizes he left a couple of things out. But Joshua said, that's all right. When I take it back up, I'm the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
I'm going to bring it back to his remembrance. Okay, so now read the second chapter where I think it's with the man. How's it start off? Just read the second chapter.
7:1. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished,
uh-huh.
and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, Elohim ended his work, which he had made.
Mm-hmm.
And he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had made. And Elohim blessed the seventh day and sanctified it. Because in it he had rested from all his work, which Elohim created.
Now he rested from his work. Now you would think, oh, this took 7 days. But it's going to tell you. Keep reading. This should be a scripture.
Genesis 2:4. These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth, mm-hmm. and they were created in the day that Yahweh Elohim made the earth.
Now they were created in the day, not the days, as we just went through, but in the day, that is the day of eternity. That's when they were created, okay? Now, I need you to get down to where the man, where it says, has it caused it to rain yet or something? It hasn't caused it to rain yet. It's about the the dew, the herb. Just read where it is. Continue.
2:4. These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created, in the day that Yahweh Elohim made the earth and the heavens,
mm-hmm.
and every plant of the field before it was in the
earth. That's it. Keep going.
And every herb of the field before it grew.
Mm-hmm.
For Yahweh Elohim had not caused it to rain upon the earth.
So now he's bringing this back to Moses. Because see, Moses saw this, but he didn't mention it the first time. But now Moses is up the third trip, and he's seeing a rerun of the vision. And so now Joshua, who is Elohim, is bringing this back to his remembrance. Say, look, I hadn't caused it to rain yet, you know, about urban affairs, and it didn't rain, because what happened was a dew would rise up from the ground and would water the earth, but continue quickly.
And Yahweh had not allowed, caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was not a man to till the ground.
Uh-huh.
But there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh Elohim formed man of the dust of the ground.
Uh-huh. Now see, now he goes into a detail about how he formed the man. See? And see how he created from the dust of the ground. See, now here he is here. He created from the dust of God. But he's not animated yet. So he's in a death-like state. Because he's not animated. He ain't moving. And he is immersed in the spirit, because it said, see, it says the breath of life here. See, he's immersed in that. A type is Yahshua breathed on his disciples. He immersed him in his breath. So now here he is, a death, a burial. Now here he is, resurrected, the division between body and soul. Continue reading.
2:6, but there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. And Yahweh Elohim formed man of the dust of the ground.
Uh-huh.
And breathed into his nostrils the breath of life.
All right, death and a burial. Read.
And man became a living soul.
Resurrection.
And Yahweh Elohim planted the garden. Mm-hmm. Eastward
indeed. Uh-huh.
And there he put the man.
Now he put the man there. Most holy place. Now see, now look here. We talked about, see these attributes here? This theosophy. See these attributes here. Alright, I got it here. Alright. Now here, see if you look. Maybe I can do it like this. No, I can't. Oh, maybe I can. All right. I'll try it.
Yeah.
All right. Here. How am I doing? I'm pointing to this.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Here. Here's the man. Here's the man. Okay, his body, soul, spirit. Look at these attributes here. You see these six here in the most holy place, three in the holy place. This is empty. Here's the body. See, the body, before he's animated, see, it's dead. See, just compare. It's empty. See what I'm saying? And then now he's filled with a soul, a living soul, and a spirit. See, because the body and the soul emanate from the spirit law that's within him. So now here are these attributes here, just slide these attributes over to the spirit and the soul. Get it? That's what shows you that the soul is made up of these attributes. Whereas the body, yeah, the body is made up of spirit, it's spirit materialized, and it's the same thing, because your physical body is a reflection of those attributes. But it's flesh, it's empty. See? It means nothing. The flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of Yahweh. See, so that, I'm just showing this in comparison to that. See, these attributes here is the soul of the man being emanated by the spirit law here. See, that's where these attributes here. Okay, like that. All right, keep reading the scripture.
Ninth verse. And out of the ground made Yahweh Elohim to grow every tree that is pleasant to sight,
uh-huh,
and good for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge.
Two trees in the garden. John confirms that, because you read in John the Revelator, in Revelation. He said he saw two olive trees in that garden, see? Alright, why? Because one represents the tree of life, the other represents the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Okay, which they were told not to touch. Alright, continue reading.
10 verse. And a river went out of Eden to water the garden, and from thence it was parted, and became into
at the four heads. Now I remember Dr. Kinley would say this, and he wrote it in a textbook about the four races of man. And see, because there were four rivers that sprung out from the garden that would represent the four races of man coming out of the man. You know, primarily the black, the white, the red, and the yellow. Right? See, out here, out of the garden. Right? Because Acts 17 chapter says, from one man or one blood, all nations of men to populate the whole earth out of one man. Okay? Continue reading.
The name of the first is Pison, that mm-hmm. is it which covers the whole land of Kabbalah,
uh-huh,
where there is gold. And the gold of that land is good. There
tonic stone.
Mm-hmm.
And the name of the second river is Gihon, the same as that that compasses the whole land of Ethiopia.
Mm-hmm.
And the name of the third river is Hapel, mm-hmm. that is which goes toward the east of Syria.
Now that river still exists today. Mm-hmm. We call it the Tigris River. And said that's over there in Iraq. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
And the fourth river is Euphrates.
It's the Euphrates. That still exists today. Okay? Go ahead.
And Yahweh Elohim took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it.
Uh-huh.
And Yahweh Elohim commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die.
Okay, continue.
And Yahweh Elohim said, it is not good that the man should be alone.
Mm-hmm.
I will make him and help me.
Now he's going to make him unhelp me, because he looked around and saw the animals. They had their mates. And man, the man, you know, he looked around. He couldn't do nothing with them. However, the man was complete within himself because he was made a hermaphrodite. He was made in the image and likeness of Elohim. The way Dr. Kelly put it, he was a man that had a womb. He had a womb. A womb. He was a man with a womb. And the womb and the rib was taken out of the man to make a womb man. We just say woman for short. But that's what you are. You're a womb man. You know? Some of you might be a wonder womb man. Let's keep reading.
19. And out of the ground, Yahweh Elohim formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them.
In other words, he brought the male and the female, because in other words, they represented the king and the queen of their species. See, and he brought them to the man. And the man, you know, said, okay, dog, cat, monkey, giraffe, lion, tiger, you know, he named them all. They were the king and queen of their species, but here he was. He's naming them. So that would make Adam king of kings. In a type. All right? Continue.
And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof.
Mm-hmm.
And Adam gave names to all cattle, and to the fowl of the air, and to every beast of the field.
Mm-hmm.
But for Adam, there was not found an helpmeet for him.
Read.
Yahweh Elohim caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam.
All right, now here we got here. Here's the point. Here he is laying. He's in a deep sleep, which is a type of death. And he is immersed in that sleep. See? And now he's getting, you got a problem there or something? Is it going out?
No, it's fine. Everything's fine.
It said
better. 20%. No. What does it say?
Bad. I took it out
with two. No, you gotta keep that in there. That's what it's slipping out. Yeah. Yeah. Okay?
Yeah.
No, just let it lay on the floor.
Stand on the other side.
On the other side? Okay, by the way, okay. All right. Right here. All right, here's Adam. He's in a deep sleep and he is buried. He's death and he's immersed, and this lightning bolt is showing an operation is being made, an incision. Okay? And it says, the woman immersed in Yahshua. See, and we have that separate words. Because the woman is immersed in Adam. Okay? So now, here, keep reading.
And he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh and said thereof. And the rib which Yahweh Elohim had taken from man. Made
you
a woman and brought her into the man.
Okay, now, here it is here. We have a veil, the division of the sexes. The word sex itself means to divide. So there's a division here. The woman was taken out of the man and she was brought to him. You know, when Adam woke up, she was standing there in front of him. She was at his feet. And then he woke up. And see, that's a principle. Because you can, if you understand that, you can look into the book of Ruth, for an example in the prophecy, because when you read about Boaz, maybe we should read that. I think it's in the third chapter of Ruth, and Boaz was in the threshing floor, somewhere in there.
I don't stay there. said this said it was using power? Okay. Yeah. That's because it wasn't.
Three and one says, then they only her mother-in-law said it to her.
All right. What do you got? Hello?
Three and one?
No, go down. It says way down in the chapter. When the Boaz is at the threshing floor.
Yes, three and six.
Three and six. And she went down unto the floor and did according to all that her mother-in-law bade her.
Uh-huh.
And when Boaz had eaten and drunk, and his heart was merry, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of corn, and she came softly and uncovered his feet and laid her down.
Uh-huh.
And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid and turned himself, and behold, a woman laid at his
feet. You got to tighten. Yeah. I knew this.
Eighth verse. And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid and turned himself, and behold, a woman lay at his feet.
So he was asleep, and he woke up, and a woman was at his feet. See, what else does it say?
And he said, who art thou? And she answered, I am Ruth, thy handmaid.
Uh-huh.
Spread therefore thy skirt over thy handmaid. But thou art a near
kinsman. See, in other words, he was her redeemer. He was going to be the one to redeem her mother-in-law, Naomi, for her property from a relative, to redeem the name and their inheritance. He was the redeemer. Look, the woman, see, here's Adam. The woman, Adam wakes up and there's a woman at his feet. And we just read about Boaz. He went to sleep and a woman was at his feet. Just draw a line. Here we got Yahshua. When Yahshua resurrected from the grave, who did he meet? He met a woman, didn't he? See, he met a woman. It's gotta be the same thing in principle. Everything is correlated. Once you understand, you see these things, then you say, oh, okay, well this is the same thing that happened down over here and over here. And it's because of the repetition of it, then that gives you confidence that, oh, well, Yahweh's running this. Because he's just simply repeating it over and over. You may not see it here, but maybe you see it over here or over here. See, that kind of thing. Okay? Now, go back to Genesis.
22. And the rib which Yahweh Elohim had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man.
And brought her unto the man, okay?
And Adam said, this is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh.
Flesh. Now, that's another veil. Says so right here. Unity of masculine and feminine sexes. So now here he is. He's got them together. Now so he said, this is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. Read.
She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man.
She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Read.
Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife and they shall be one flesh.
That's why it says here, see Yahshua and his bride. This is a type of that. Now this angel back here, I don't know why there's a controversy to it, but it ain't none to me. This is not Yahshua. This is Lucifer spying out their nakedness. Now the way they got it drawn here is incorrect. The way Dr. Kinnick drew it in the textbook, he's got Lucifer way in the back because he's entering into the garden. See, and he's entering into the garden on the 40th day of Moses' vision. Now see, you don't know how long they're up here except according to Moses' vision because the sun in the sky didn't set. And it was always, so it was like a type of the day. But according to Moses' vision, they were up here 40 days. So now here, let's just read the transgression.
three and one. Now the serpent was more subtle than in the beasts of the field, which Yahweh Elohim had made.
Uh-huh.
And he said unto the woman, yea, have Elohim said ye shall not eat of the tree of the Lord?
Now see, now this is the plate we want to start. This plate starts up here. See, and just like what we read with Jacob's ladder, angels ascending and descending on the plate, on the ladder. This is a descending place, so I'm starting up here, in the most holy place, because this is where the story starts, up here, all right? They're in a type of heaven, all right? Here's Lucifer trying to draw the woman away. It's no different than what he did over here, because here he drew one third of the angels away, all right? And they're a type of the woman too, or the bride. So
He drew a third away, just like he's trying to draw the woman away. He went after the bride here, or the woman here, or the weaker one here, just like he's doing over here. He wasn't going to go to Adam. Adam looked a little too much like Elohim. Okay, so he wasn't going to, see, as long as the woman was in the man, you don't see the devil happening, you don't see him around. But as soon as the woman was taken out of the man, here he comes. I go, oh, okay. He comes sliding on in. It's the same thing in principle. Here he is. All right, continue.
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden,
mm-hmm.
but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim has said, ye shall not eat of it,
mm-hmm.
neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die.
Read.
And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die.
Uh-huh.
For Elohim doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as Elohim, or gods, knowing good and evil.
Now see, he deceived her. Really, she was created holy and innocent. She didn't understand she was already like Elohim. He's trying to tell her, well, you'll be like Elohim, not realize she was already that way. She was created in his image and likeness. But he deceived her. All right, continue.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise,
uh-huh.
she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat,
read.
And gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat.
Mm-hmm. In other words, he sat back and watched her do it, and knew what she was doing was wrong, but he just said, well, I gave up. I said, well, I'm responsible for it. I'm not going to let her suffer by herself. I'll take responsibility for it. So he did do it. Just like Yahshua did when he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, if it be thy will, take this cup away from me. But thy will be done. See? He didn't want to, but thy will be done. See? And he's just like in the Garden of Gethsemane, an angel appeared there, just like an angel appeared here. See? And Yahshua was fulfilling that. He said, and he checked on his disciples three times in the garden. And then he said, what, could you not wait 1 hour with me? Well, why would he say that? Well, see, because he understood. See, 1,000 years is one day according to Yahweh. Is as one day, all right? So if you were to take 1,000 and divide it by, by 24 hours in a day, it would come out to about 41.1 years, rounded off to 40. So 40 years would be the same as one hour prophetically. So when Joshua said, could you not wait but 1 hour with me? He was saying that in fulfillment of how long Adam and Eve was in the Garden of Eden. 40 days, according to Moses' vision. But go back to the scripture.
7th verse. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked.
Uh-huh.
And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves apron.
Mm-hmm.
And they heard the voice of Yahweh Elohim walking in the garden in the cool of the day.
Uh-huh.
And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of Yahweh Elohim among the trees of the garden.
Read.
Yahweh Elohim called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard that voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, who told thee that thou was naked?
He was told not to touch the tree, because he said if they did, they would surely die. He died in his consciousness. As soon as he died, that's when the sun in the sky began to move. It began to, because it's reflecting the death of the man Adam. As the man Adam is dying in his consciousness, he died, so is the sun in the sky. It's moving, it's going toward darkness. So Adam is descending in, I'm talking about spiritually, he's descending into darkness. That's being reflected by the sun in the sky, being going into darkness. And in some illustrations, they usually have, like at sunset, you see different colors, red, blue, and purple. It's a veil. Now a veil has been erected, a partition. See, here, there was no partition between the soul and the spirit. Though there's a principle of a veil there, but there was no partition. Here, because of the transgression, now there's a partition. There's a separate, because it's like the way it just said, it's showing you, where are you, Adam? Where are you, Adam? I don't see you anymore, Adam. There's a veil up now. There's a veil, it's a partition. Remember, because we read it out the textbook. The veil, the principle is to conceal or to reveal. Now it's the principle of conceal. Yahweh is now concealed from the man. Death has come to the man. And through the first man, Adam, death to everybody. Or that veil is now in everybody. Now, you don't know, you're in darkness, but you think you're all right. You're just walking along, not knowing you in the dark. Hey, what's going on, You don't know until you come into this class and we start telling you something about this pattern, about this truth. Then the veil is taken off, it's written twain. And then all of a sudden, wow, this is different, I can see now. I didn't know I was blind before, but now I can see. But this is where it started. That's the principle of the veil. All right, keep going.
And he said, who told thee that thou was naked? Is thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to me to be with me, she gave of me the tree, and I did eat. And Yahweh Elohim said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle,
mm-hmm.
and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and thus shalt thou eat all the days of thy life.
That was brilliant.
And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
All right, that's what it said about enmity. See, between her seed and the seed of the serpent. Open hatred. I always say, Hatfields and McCoy type of thing. Shoot on sight. Okay, continue reading.
16, unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake.
Mm-hmm.
In sorrow shall thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread.
That says, in the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread. We'll go backwards. Bread, that's in the holy place. Why? That's where the table of shewbread is. This plate gives in the holy place. What are we looking for? Light, bread, intercessor. Now we have found the bread. Okay? Keep reading.
Till thou, in the sweat of thy face shall thou eat bread.
Now I said in the sweat of thy face. Now that's down here. The sweat of that, that's the water principle down here. It says we've got it written, the sweat of thy face. He's already dead. Well, blood is on his head. Now we got the water principle here. Sweat the sweat of thy face. We got the bread principle here in the holy place. Keep reading.
Till thou return into the ground, for out of it was thou taken. For dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return.
Keep going.
And Adam called his wife's name Eve, because she was the mother of all living.
Mm-hmm.
Unto Adam also, and to his wife, did Yahweh Elohim make coats of skins and clothing. And Yahweh Elohim said, behold, the man has become as one of us.
Now that was, he put on coats of skin. Why? And he's getting ready to kick them out. That's another veil principle. Putting on coats of skin. The first departmental veil, because he's getting ready to kick him on out. Okay, keep going.
And Yahweh Elohim said, behold, the man has become as one of us, to know good and evil.
Read.
And now, lest he put forth his hand, and take also of the tree of life, and eat, and live forever. Therefore, Yahweh Elohim sent him forth from the garden of Eden, to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the garden of Eden cherubims, and a flaming sword, which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life.
Now here's an angel here, showing them the egress, and he's got a flaming sword. That's light. That would be like the candlestick, all right? And he's interceding, in other words, he's the one interceding between the garden, between the tree of life and them. He's the one interceding. You can't get through, you gotta get through me to get to them, and that ain't happening. He's got this flaming sword in his hand, all right? So that's bread, light, intercessor. Alright, he's coming out, that's the spirit, this angel, that's the spirit, that's the cup of holy anointing oil. Here's the sweat on his face, and here's the man Adam. He's dead in his conscience. 930 years later, he's going to die a natural death. So that's showing you the principle of the pattern in a descending fashion. Okay? Now, we come over here, read the, I think it's the fourth chapter, where it starts, where it talks with Cain.
4:1. And the man knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived, and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man, even Yahweh. And she again bare his brother Abel. And Abel was a herder of sheep, and Cain was a tiller of the ground. And it came to pass at the end of the days that Cain brought up the fruit of the ground and offered unto Yahweh. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of their fat. And Yahweh had respect unto Abel and to his offering.
Now he had respect to Abel, read.
But unto Cain and to his offering, he had no respect.
Not one iota. I'm going to explain why, read.
And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance failed.
And he was pissed off. This is getting real. He was really pissed. Like, what? I farmed all year. I worked out in the field and all this, and I'm offering him my, and it's rejected. I'm like, well, what's up with that? But there's three reasons why Cain's sacrifice was not accepted. One, you go back and read in Genesis that the earth had been cursed for man's sake. So he's bringing up vegetables and fruit from a cursed earth. Two, he's bringing forth just fruits and vegetables. And as the old saying goes, you can't get blood from a turnip. Why? Because without shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. And three, he's out of order. Because according to the pattern here, see, when you come through the gate, the first thing is a death. See, and then there's a death, then a burial, then a resurrection. First fruits represents a resurrection. How are you going to sit up and offer a resurrection when you haven't even offered up a sacrifice for sin yet? That was showing you that he was exalted in his own mind. He was like, I ain't got to do that here. My first fruits, I'm. but wait a minute, you got to offer blood here. See, without offering of blood, there's no remission of sin. I ain't doing no sin. Well, I got over it. Here's my first fruits. I'm resurrected. The arrogance, the self-exaltation of Cain. That's what it's really showing you. See, keep reading.
6 verse. And Yahweh said unto Cain, why art thou wrong? And why is thy countenance fallen?
Read.
If thou dost well, thou should be exalted. And if thou dost not well, sin offering lieth at the door. And unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. And Cain talked with Abel.
That's in other words, he was told, look, go see your brother and just get a lamb and do the right thing. Alright? So now he's going over to Cain. Cain's going over to Abel's place. Right? Now let's just look at it together right here by the pattern. It says now Cain, the first step of the pattern is what? The first step. Is what?
The gate.
Read.
And Cain talked with Abel, his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. And Yahweh said unto Cain, where is Abel, thy brother?
He went to Cain. Came with the Abel's place, by the sheep coat, by the gate of the sheep coat. And then he went in, and then he slew his brother, Abel, that's a death. And then he went and buried him. All right, and then read.
And Yahweh said unto Cain, where is Abel, thy brother? And he said, I know not, am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood cries unto me from the ground.
Now here's Cain, see, he killed his brother, and we have written here, his conscience is immersed in wickedness. In other words, he didn't think nothing about it. As per his answer to Elohim, he said, you know, am I my brother's keeper? In other words, am I guarding sheep like him? You know, I mean, what, you know? But that was his heart and mind. Keep reading.
And now art thou cursed from the ground, which hath opened her mouth to receive thy brother's blood in thy hand. When thou tillest the ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee her strength. A wanderer shall thou be in the earth. And Cain said unto Yahweh, my iniquity is greater than I can bear. Behold, thou hast driven me out this day from the face of the ground, and from thy face shall I be hid. And I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer in the earth, and it shall come to pass everyone that findeth me shall slay
him.
And Yahweh said unto him, therefore, whosoever slays Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And Yahweh set a mark upon Cain.
Now, what is that mark? What did it look like? Well, here's Abel's shepherd cook. This is his shepherd. See? And listen, when Cain went over to Abel, he went over there and he was hotter than a firecracker. I mean, he went over there and he just literally cussed his brother out. Oh, well, who do you think you are? You think you're so good? And he was just going off, and Abel's just standing there, calm and cool. You know, he's not saying anything. And he's got his shepherd crook in his hand. And Cain took the shepherd's crook from Abel, and then he killed it with it. Now, the mark that Yahweh Elohim put on Cain was really the shepherd's crook. When you turn the shepherd's crook aside and upside down, it sort of looks like this, a six. And that's the mark that was put on Cain's head so that everybody could see, to let everybody know, don't bother him. He's mine. I'll deal with him with my own good pleasure, okay? So that's the mark that Cain was put on. Abel's shepherd's crook that he took, that Cain took and killed Abel with, upside down, was like a six. That was put on his head. That's the mark put on Cain. And here he is out here. See, he's out here in the land of wandering, or the land of dying. But his wife, read.
And Cain went out from the presence of Yahweh and dwelt in the land of Nod on the east of Eden.
Mm-hmm.
And Cain knew his wife, and uh-huh. She conceived and bare Enoch.
And she drew his wife, and she conceived. When did she conceive? 40 weeks later. That's the 40 principle on this plate. And see, and then Enoch was born. Enoch coming through the veil, coming through the loins, is like coming through the veil. So here he is, it's his son Enoch, and then there's Cain here, flanked by his son and his wife, imitating Yahweh like the Ark of the Covenant. So you keep reading.
And he built a city and called the name of the city after the name of his son Enoch.
Uh-huh.
And unto Enoch was born Iran.
Mm-hmm.
And Iran began Bethuel,
mm-hmm.
and Bethuel begat Methusiel, and Methusiel
mm-hmm.
begat Lamech,
mm-hmm.
and Lamech took unto him two wives.
Okay, now see, a dynasty was set up. The city of Enoch was the capital of the earth at that time. And a dynasty was set up, and here's Lamech, who's the sixth generation from Cain. Here he is. Let's see how he feels about things. Read.
The name of the one was Adam, and the name of the other, Zillah.
There they are right here. Here's Lamech, and here's two wives preceding him. Why? They would be like his two witnesses. They went forth to proclaim the greatness of Lamech. They were his law and prophets, witnessing to him. Get it? Just like Jannes and Jambres witnessing to the power of faith. Okay? So a satanic trinity. How about that? That's what that is. Because see, Satan says, I will be like the Most High. Yahweh said, look, I out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let the matter be established. Satan reads the Bible too. Okay, I got my two witnesses too. I will be like the Most High. I got my two witnesses to profess my glory, to witness to my glory. Okay, but read.
And Adam bare Jabal.
Mm-hmm.
He was the father of such as
uh-huh.
dwell in tents, and of such as have cattle. And his brother's name was Jubal. And he was the father of all, such as handle the harp
mm-hmm.
and work. And Zillah, she also bare Tubal-Cain,
mm-hmm.
and instructed of every artificer in copper and iron.
Yeah,
and
his
sister.
In other words, they had a civilization going. These weren't a bunch of cave folks, Neanderthals, the club, you know, that's what they think, you know, prehistoric man, that kind of stuff. It wasn't like that. These people were smart. They were intelligent. They were builders. You know, they created a civilization that ruled and was violent, as we're going to find out. Keep reading.
And the sister of Tubal-Cain was Naamah.
Mm-hmm.
And Lamech said unto her, unto his wives, Ada and Zillah,
mm-hmm.
hear my voice, ye wives of Lamech.
Read.
Hearken unto my speech, for I have slain a man for wounding me,
mm-hmm.
and a young man for bruising me.
Mm-hmm.
If Cain shall be avenged sevenfold, truly Lamech 70 and sevenfold.
70 and 70, or 490. Mm-hmm. That's a principle. We're going to dwell on that today. We'll keep reading.
And Adam knew his wife again, and she bare a son and called his name Seth.
Seth. Now, Seth was the one who replaced Abel. All right. Keep reading.
And Adam knew his wife again, and she bare a son and called his name Seth. For Elohim said, she hath appointed me another seed instead of Abel, whom Cain slew. And to Seth, to him also, there was born a son, and he called his name Enosh. Then began men to call themselves by the name of Yahweh.
Keep going.
Fifth chapter. This is the book of the generations of Adam. In the day that Elohim created man, in the likeness of Elohim made he him. Male and female created he them, and blessed them, and called their name Adam, in the day when they were created. And Adam lived 130 years, and begat a son in his own likeness, after his image, and called his name Seth.
He called his name Seth, who replaced Abel. Continue.
And the days of Adam after he had begotten Seth were 800 years, and he begat sons and daughters.
And he begat sons and daughters.
And all the days that Adam lived were 930 years, and he died.
All right, I'm going to get back to this in a minute. Right now, I'm going to jump on this plate here. Plate 17, birth translation of Enoch. Get to where Enoch is at. The prophet Enoch. It might be the fourth chapter. Two of them, so don't get them confused, okay? This, now we're reading about the righteous Enoch, as opposed to the unrighteous one. All right, read.
And Enoch lived 65 years and begat Methuselah. And Enoch walked with Elohim after he begat Methuselah 300 years and begat sons and daughters.
He begat sons and daughters. Read.
And all the days of Enoch were 365 years. And Enoch walked with Elohim, and he was not, for Elohim took.
He was translated, okay? Now, let's look at this by the pattern. Here he is, he's born seventh from Adam. Now, we read in Genesis, in the third chapter of Genesis, about the enmity between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent, okay? Get Genesis 6 chapter right quick.
Genesis 6 and 1.
Yeah.
And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of Elohim saw the daughters of men, that they were fair. And they took their wives of all which they chose.
Now here's what some people interpret. They interpret the sons of Elohim being Seth, and they took the wife, daughters of men. In other words, they say that the two seeds are corrupted. That is not so. Because we read in Genesis, it said that there would be enmity between the two seeds. So they're not getting together. In other words, these other sons and daughters got a choice to make. They'd either marry up into Cain's family, which is an unrighteous seed, or they could marry up into Seth's family, which is a righteous seed. See, Enoch was of that righteous seed, all right? Keep reading.
And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, and the sons of Elohim saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took the wives of all which they chose.
Now the sons of Elohim, this is who Elohim, Adam was Elohim. When it says the sons of Elohim, they're the sons of Adam. Because Adam was Elohim. He was created in the image and likeness of Elohim. See, that's what it's talking about. The sons, the daughters of Elohim, they got a choice to make. They either can marry into this righteous seed, or they can marry into the daughters of Cain. Okay. See, most of them married into Cain's seed. Because why? Keep reading.
Yahweh said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for he is but flesh. Let his days be 120 years.
120 years, read. That's becoming a note. But read.
There were Nephilim in the earth in those days.
And Nephilim were giants. That's you reading the Holy Name. They were giants. See, A.B. Trainor didn't believe it, but I'm telling you, they were giants. See, the man Adam, when he was created, was a giant of a man. More than likely about 30 feet tall. They say, well, how do you know? Well, look here.
I got a pattern to look at. See the tabernacle, see the board. Where's it at?
Don't you have
come over here. Move about, just move, don't be afraid. Look here. It says here, the bone structure of a man represents pillars, boards, and bars in the tabernacle. The long boards in the tabernacle were 15 feet long. That would be like the long bones in your legs. Now, let's say from my foot to my torso is 15 feet. And if my torso is proportional, say another 15 feet, I could say Adam was roughly about 30 feet tall. Okay? Now, stop and think for a minute. Let's say this. You see her, all right? She's pretty much like, let's see, my size. I want you, no, you stand over there. No, come back. You camera person, stands over there and show us, all right? Now, what I want you to do, you see, now I want Karen to walk over there and follow Karen to that wall. Just walk over to the wall, all right? Now, as she's walking away from me, she's diminishing in size. See, where, okay, now show it, turn the camera to me. Now, from where I'm standing, Karen appears to be like this. From where I'm standing, she appears to be this tall to me. From the top of my hand to her head, to my hands to where her feet is. Because she's walking away from me, she has diminished in size. That's what happened to man. When they walked away from Elohim, they began to diminish in size. Okay, you didn't take a seat. And so to the point that when you get to the ark that Noah built, okay, now you can come on up, please. All right. When you come up to the ark that was built, the dimensions of the ark, the height was 45 feet. See, that means that each level was 15 feet. And the door to the ark had to be 15 feet tall. So that lets you know that the man who was 30 feet with Adam, by the time it got to Noah, they have diminished to about 15 feet. They diminished, you understand, so that they'd be able to walk through the ark. That tells me they couldn't have been more than 15 feet tall, because the door of the ark was 15 feet tall. You understand my point? See, this is how you use the pattern to deceive things. And once you get into the practice of it, other little things will come to life. You say, oh, okay, no, I get that. I get that now, you know, because and it fits. See, now, you come on up. Now, here we are with Enoch. Here he is hiding in a cave. See? Yeah, you gotta, no, this is, you can tighten it and then let go and then do it and then go back and loose it. All right. I'm a teacher. You gotta learn something like that. My people are sick of me at home. They know it too. Don't worry. I will be back home and you'll have me lovingly pointing fingers this, that, and the other, okay? Yeah. Alright, here's Enoch here, born seventh from Adam. There's a death decree out because we said there was enmity between the two seeds. Alright? So he's under a death decree. And he's hidden in a cave. You know, that's a burial. Here's the dove, which is the spirit, shining on Enoch. Keep reading where you're at.
There were giants in the earth, fourth verse, in those days, and also after that, when the sons of Elohim came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth,
read.
And that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually.
Evil continually. There's one scripture that talks about the violence. It's in there. Maybe a verse or two down. In that same chapter, where you at? The violence. It says violence.
Oh, violence.
Violence, yes. It's in that chapter. Just look down.
13.
Thank you.
And Yahweh and Elohim said unto Noah, the end of our flesh is come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them.
What violence? See, people think this is random violence. The violence I'm trying to show you is the violence of persecution of the righteous seed. How do I know? Look here on the migratory path. Wasn't there violence up here?
Didn't Pharaoh order the death of all the boy babies, two and under? Isn't that violence?
Yeah.
See, looking for that one. It's the same thing here with Enoch. There was violence looking for that one. See, so here he is under a death decree, hidden in the cave, but he's full of the Holy Spirit. And here he is prophesying. And here's Lamech and his two wives. He's prophesying against these folk. And he's full of the Holy Spirit. Now, mind you, Enoch, when he prophesied 50 years after the death of Adam. In other words, Adam died 930 years. Enoch prophesied in the year 980 AM. That stands for Anno Mundi. That means the numbers are going forward. He prophesied 50, in fact, we can read his prophecy, Jude 14. Just read it. Jude 14.
Mm-hmm. And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, mm-hmm. Behold, Yahweh cometh with 10,000 of his sons.
That's what he prophesied. See, he prophesied the end of that age. Continue.
To execute judgment upon all, and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, mm-hmm. which they have ungodly committed, and of all their hard speeches, which ungodly sinners spoken against
him. All right. Now, let's just look. Look where we're at. We're in the holy place. What's the principles of the holy place? See, light, bread, incense. So here he is. He's full of the Holy Spirit. He's full of the light. And the words he speak, they are spirit, they are light. That's the bread. He's got a class going here. He's got a class. He's teaching folks. So the spirit, he's teaching the spirit, the words he speak, that's the bread. And it's the Holy Spirit in it that's being the intercessor. Because he's the one telling people, oh, the end of the age is coming. Better get ready. It's the end of the age. And so that's him prophesying. And he's prophesying 50 years after the death of Adam. Then 7 years later, he's translated. What do you mean? The veil principle is he's taken off the flesh. And now he's translated. Now he's translated out. He's translated out of that he didn't see death. Now that didn't mean he went to heaven. Because some people say, oh, he went to heaven. No, because the scripture says no man has come down from heaven, save he who has come from heaven, who is in heaven, which is Yahshua. And see, because Yahshua is the first fruits to rise. Okay? So now that's just showing you, according to the pattern, how this event happened. Look, and you got him here, he's translated, he's flanked by two, by Michael and Gabriel, which is like the Ark of the Covenant. Okay? Because see, when Yahshua, just draw a line. Because when Yahshua ascended, wasn't there two men waiting there? Two angels there? When Yahshua ascended on the Mount of Olives?
Oh yeah.
Is that true or not? If you don't know, we can read it. It's Acts. Acts 1:9. Let's just read that, just to show you that it's a fulfillment of what happened back here with Enoch.
Acts 1:9.
Uh-huh.
And when he had spoken these things while they beheld, was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight.
Uh-huh.
And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel.
See, two men, why? Because the same thing back here. What do you mean? Look at the pattern. See, up here in the cloud, and the high priest came up here. He had to get between two men, these two archangels, because he had to stand between the two staves and flick that blood. It's the same thing in principle. Do you understand? That's all you're doing. You're just looking at this and finding the principles, and you're just making comparative analysis to it. That's all that you're doing. Okay?
Where are we at here? How much time we got left?
20 minutes.
20 minutes? Okay. Anything else y'all want to get into? Any plate or anything you want to get into? I'm your servant tonight. But do you see what I'm saying when I talk about the pattern? Because I hope I showed the principles of descending and ascending, you know, and you're just making the comparison to the tabernacle pattern and to the migratory pattern. That's all you're doing. You're making the comparison and thereby reading the scriptures. Hopefully, it's designed that you would read the scriptures. And that you would look at the scriptures according to the eyes of the author.
which is the tabernacle pattern. That's really all you're doing. And see, Dr. Kinley, when he set up the school and set up these charts and did about his teaching, he hoped that if you would see the repetitiousness of the pattern, I think the analogy he used once was like if you took a 2x4 and you whacked the mule in the ear, you just whacked the mule in the ear, you're going to give him 40 whacks. Somewhere between 1 and 40, that one whack, bam, it's going to get through, it's going to sink in, the mule's going to say, oh, okay, I get it now, I get it. That's the whole idea behind all of these correlations. Maybe you won't see it on this plate. Maybe you'll see it here. You may not see it on the plate that I just, some of the plates I just went to, but maybe you'll see it over here, over here. Somewhere up here, you're going to see it. Somewhere. And when you do, you're going to be like, oh, okay. Then that light is going to shine out of darkness and you will be enlightened. Questions, comments, anything?
Question. Can you go back over that third heaven? We've had one question about that again.
What's the question?
Explaining the third heaven. I heard you say first heaven is space, second heaven was the firmament or the atmosphere, mm-hmm. and then the third heaven was not geographical.
Right. Okay. Take that and go back to the middle because I'm going to use the Moses chart. All right. Let me say something about. No, come back closer. Come back closer. I hate far. I like closeness.
I see.
Well, that's why I say, just shoot up close. There you go. Yeah. Everybody wants to shoot far. Like, oh, I'm all, get up here. I try to show them stuff that I learned in school. See, people want to do the consumer way. I'm trying to show. I said, look, this is what they taught me in school. All right. And you got to point the camera this way. Because I can tell they point this way.
Well, you should.
Let me show you. Okay, there you go. You got to tighten so this won't fall. And then come up here. This is fine. Just zoom in a little. And like that. And there we go. I know. Right? See? I know. I went to school. All right. Migratory pattern. Okay. This is the greater and more perfect sanctuary, which is the universe. All right? This is Egypt, which is the court roundabout. This is the wilderness of Sinai, which is the holy place. This is Canaan's land, which is the most holy place. Now, when I say the greater and more perfect sanctuary, which is the universe, this is what I mean by that. Egypt would be like the physical creation. The wilderness of Sinai would be like the angelic creation. Canaan's land would be like spirit law. The physical creation and the angelic creation emanate from spirit law. It's like the hydrogen atom. The electron and the proton emanate from spirit law. This is a better example. Here's the angelic creation here. Here's the physical creation. Proton and electron, or the angelic creation, the physical creation, abides within Yahweh or eternity. This is the cloud, all right, of which it is embedded in, okay? It's the same principle here. Here's Elohim, what we said earlier. He's standing on the pavement of a sapphire stone. That sapphire stone is the earth. The proton and the earth will be like the electron. This figure is the same as this heart here. This heart is in the midst of the cloud, which is the third of the invisible part, which is Yahweh. Okay? Now, what she asked about, the third heaven. This is what Paul talks about. Now, the first heaven is space. The earth hangs like a ball of space. Space is black. All right? See? You're standing on the earth. Therefore, you're in the first heaven.
We're all in the first heaven, physically speaking, because we're on the earth, and the earth is like a ball in space. The second heaven is the atmospheric heaven. See, we breathe it, rain comes down from it, birds fly through it. That's the atmospheric heaven. The third heaven that Paul talks about is not geographical. It's a state or a condition. If it's geographical, then kindly tell me where it's at. Is it above the sun, moon, and star? Is it another dimension or what? It's not a location. It's a state. See, it's a state of eternity, really. And that's not geographical. All of that exists within eternity, just like time does. Time begins and ends in the realm of eternity. See, the third heaven, which is the real heaven, which is the only heaven that really is, that makes any, that's of any bearing. The other heavens are a type of first heaven, second heaven, third heaven. Space, atmosphere, eternity. Okay? That's the universe. See, the scientists only know about the physical part. And they dismiss what we call the angelic creation or the incorporeal creation. They dismiss that. But we understand it exists. And we can understand it by understanding the physical, as the scripture says. It takes the natural to understand the physical. For example, we talked up here about Adam being cast out. You can look at Adam being cast out and compare it to plate 14, which is angelic transgression, on how Lucifer was cast out. See, when Adam was cast, and not the woman. The woman followed him out. But Lucifer, he was cast out. And those one-third he deceived, they followed him. See, I can look at Adam, I can look at this to get an understanding of what happened in the heavenlies. It takes the natural to understand the spiritual. Just to give you an idea, Genesis 50 and 19, which is not, okay, I think I can get this in here. It's just a small thing, but what I'm trying to show you is what Dr. Kelly is showing through this vision on how to understand the various aspects of the purpose of Yahweh. And for that matter, what is the purpose of Yahweh? Anybody know? What is the purpose of Yahweh? The purpose of Yahweh is to propagate or to produce offspring. If that be the case, then what is the adversary's job? His job is to negate that, to stop it, birth control. That's why down here, Pharaoh issued an edict, kill all the boy babies, two and under. Why? Because he was up in the garden. He heard what was told to the woman, the sheep, that she would bear children in pain and that she would be saved in childbearing. He heard that. So all he's got to do is, all I got to do is just exercise birth control. Kill it when it's born. And that's what he tried to do down here, because he was expecting. But Yahweh threw a loop on him. He pulled a turn on put a move on him. He didn't come through the loins of a woman. He just appeared down there as Joshua, son of Nun. But here, Joshua, he came through the loins of a woman. What happened? Didn't Herod issue a death decree for all the boy babies in Bethlehem, two and under? It's the same thing. See, birth control. You can even take it further. You can take it even further. Because down here in this age, see, Dr. Kennedy sees the vision, right? But that ain't stopped the devil from looking, see, in 1933, you got Adolf Hitler. He becomes Chancellor of Germany, and what does he do? He starts rounding up the Jews. He's killing them. Why, people don't understand, why are they killing the Jews? We understand the reason. He's looking for that one. It's no different than what's been down there. And he's seeing, he reigned until 1945, which was like 12 years, which is like, and he persecuted the Jews, which is like persecuting the 12 tribes, all right? But the age changed, the dispensation changed. It's not a natural Jew in this age, it's a spiritual Jew, one within. So he missed it, all right? Now the vision came in 1931, right? So Hitler started his reign of terror 2 years after the vision. Why? Because he's looking for that one, two, and under. Just like Pharaoh did. It's the same thing in principle. You understand? See, it can't change. Okay?
Genesis.
Where we at?
Genesis 15 and 19.
Yeah, 15 and 19, yes.
And Joseph said unto them, fear not, for I am in the place of Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
But as
for me, Joseph
said unto them, fear not, for I am in the place of Elohim. That's the question.
No. Just, it says that how I read?
Uh-huh.
Says, for am I? It says, am I, don't it?
For am I in the place of Elohim?
Yeah, that's what I wanted to hear. I didn't hear that part. But am I, which the answer is, yes. But am I in the place of Elohim? Yes. He was. He was a type of El Shaddai. He was feeding those people down there. He's a type of Elohim. But read.
But as for you, ye thought evil against me.
Mm-hmm.
But Elohim meant it unto good, to bring to pass as it is this day, to save much people alive.
Okay, now jump down to where he says, I died.
24, and Joseph said unto his brother, I die, and Elohim will surely visit you, and bring you out of this land, and to the land which he sware to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And Joseph took an oath of the children of Israel, saying, Elohim will surely visit you.
He said, Elohim will surely visit you. I'm just a type. I'm in his place. But Elohim himself, he will surely visit you.
And you shall carry up my bones from him.
In other words, when he takes you up out of here, take my bones up there with you, because the bones represent the soul. In other words, don't leave me here in corruption. Take me up on out of here too, so I can get my inheritance as well. Continue.
So Joseph died, being 110 years old, and they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt.
All right, now jump over to Exodus 1.
Exodus 1. Now these are the names of the children of Israel, which came into Egypt. Every man and his household came with Jacob.
Mm-hmm.
Reuben, Simeon, Levi, and Judah. Issachar, Zebulun, and Benjamin. Dan, Naphtali, Gad, and Asher. And all the souls that came out of the loins of Jacob were 70 souls, for Joseph was in Egypt.
Really?
And Joseph died, and all his brethren, and all of that generation.
Mm-hmm.
And the children of Israel were fruitful, and increased abundantly, and multiplied, and grew exceeding mighty, and the land was filled with them.
And they grew so much. Here's a principle. Now, when Satan deceived those angels, how many angels did he deceive? How many did he deceive?
One third.
He deceived one third of an innumerable host of angels, which is innumerable. But the principle is, he deceived one third of them. So, take that principle and look it down here in Egypt. The Israelites multiply. When Pharaoh comes up, he sees all these Israelites. If you were to take a census of the population of the people in Egypt, two thirds of the people would have been Israelites, and one third would have been Egyptian. Get it? It's a principle. The natural to understand the spiritual. Keep reading.
Now there rose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph.
Now see, now here's the thing. It wasn't that he didn't know anything about Joseph. He just didn't have any respect for Joseph. That's what that means. Somebody would say, oh, he didn't know about Joseph. No. He had no respect for Joseph. That's why he didn't mind doing what he did to the Israelites. Now, look at it. That's a natural. He just arose. He just appeared all of a sudden, and he had no respect for Joseph, whom we read was a type of El Shaddai. Why? Because it's the same thing happening in the heavens. Satan rose up amongst the angels, and he had no respect for Elohim. And this is what this Pharaoh did. Read.
And he said unto his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal wisely with them, lest they multiply. And it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also unto our enemies and fight against us, and so get them up out of the land. Therefore they did set over them taskmasters to afflict them with burdens. And they built for Pharaoh treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses.
And they built treasure cities. Because remember, Joseph, see, he was in charge of the graves, and the whole world was starved, was under a famine. And they came to Egypt to buy food, and Egypt got rich. So rich that they had to build two treasure cities to hold on, not two neighborhoods, or two buildings, but two treasure cities to hold all this stuff in. Okay? But keep reading.
But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew, and they were grieved because of the children of Israel. And the Egyptians made the children of Israel to serve with rigor. Mm-hmm. And they made their lives bitter with hard labor, in water, and in brick, and in all manner of work in the field, and all their work wherein they made them serve was with rigor. And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives, mm-hmm. of which the name of one was Shiphrah, and mm-hmm. the name of the other Puah. Mm-hmm. And he said, when ye do the office of midwife to the Hebrew women, and see them upon their birth stools, if it be a son, then ye shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live. But the midwives feared Elohim, and did not as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the male children alive.
Okay, now the midwives, they feared Elohim. Why? Just take that and look at it in the spirit. Because in the heavenly, see, Satan, he tried to appeal up in heaven. He tried to appeal to Michael and Gabriel. Michael and Gabriel, go out and give me some money, you know, because, hey, look, if Pharaoh was looking for that one down here with the edict of killing the boy babies, if he was looking for that one down here, then you have to see in the heavens Satan looking for that one, because Yahshua was walking amongst his angels, looking like just any other angels. Just like Joshua, son of Nun, was down here, looked just like any other Hebrew. And as Satan was looking for Joshua down here, he was looking for Yahshua up here in the heavens. And he went to Michael again. Michael and Gabriel, go out and bring all these angels to me so I can find out where this guy is. And they said, no, we ain't going to do that, because we feared Elohim. How do you know that? Because I just read in the scriptures. One is the type of the other, Shiphrah and Puah. They said, go out, give me, you know. And they said, no, we can't do that. We feared Elohim. And here's the reason why they gave. No, read it out the King. You got the Holy Name, right? Read the Holy Name. No, read it out the King James Version. Because there's a different wording on there that I like better.
And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of one was Shiphrah, and the name of the other Puah. And he said, when ye do the office of a midwife to the Hebrew women, and see them upon the stools, if it be a son, then ye shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live. But the midwives feared God, and did not as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the men children alive. Mm-hmm. And the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said unto them, why have you done this thing, and have saved the men children alive? And the midwives said unto Pharaoh, because of the Hebrew women mm-hmm. are not as the Egyptian women.
They said, look, these Hebrew women, they're not like the Egyptian women. He said, and they're going to say, why?
For they are lively.
They are lively. It doesn't say that in the Holy Name Bible. See, yeah, it says something that don't mean. But this word, they were lively. Why? Because the root word of it is live. See, it's the same principle in the heavens. Michael Gabriel, go bring me some more angels so I can see where this Joshua. They said, no, we can't do that. And we refused to do it. Why? Because see, that two-thirds of them, they were lively. Or they were alive. Get it? See, you're taking one to see the other. Because they say, you know, the Michael, this is what the way the founder did. You can by understand. That's why I tell people understanding the migratory tract is very important, because this is going to be the basis for all your correlations, both on the charts as far as what they show through the ancient dispensations, but also what happens in the angelic creation. How are you going to know what's happening in the angelic creation if you can't see into it, you know, at any time? So you got to use types and shadows to understand what's going on. I can see Shiphrah and Puah refusing it, just like up here in the heaven, Michael and Gabriel. Well, we refuse that order too. Why? Just like they feared Elohim, Michael and Gabriel, they feared Elohim too. And just like this Pharaoh appeared on the scene all of a sudden, just like Lucifer, he just appeared on the scene all of a sudden and looked around and said, hey, you know, I don't see anybody as wise as me. I don't see anybody as beautiful as me or as smart as me. I must be here. Angelic creation, your Savior has arrived. That was the same way Pharaoh was. He said to the other Egyptians, your sin is right. See all these two-thirds? Well, I'll handle it. That's what Lucifer said up here. And what happened? There was a war that broke out in heaven. He got kicked out. See? But the point I'm making in general is understand the migratory track. Because when you do, then you'll be able to use the correlations more effectively. Because one, you're going to see how the prophets is drawing out from what Moses says. You're going to see how Joshua's fulfilling it. John on the Isle of Patmos confirming it. And this vision of the founder, especially as manifested through the 40-plate chart and all the other charts, how he's confirming what everybody in the book is saying. Moses and the prophets, Yahshua, John on the Alphabets, everything, so that you can see that what we study here is not of a man's concept. It didn't come about by somebody sitting down in a garage or in a basement just dreaming up something, you know. No, this is a divine vision and revelation. See? And the only way to truly understand this is to sit down and allow Yahweh to reveal to you how He operates. The operation of the pattern, knowing the operation of the pattern and the migratory pattern and how it's all correlated, I'll just tell you this. That really is the Holy Spirit. See, it's not eating and drinking. It's not jumping up and down or flying over the benches or saying some other than some unknown tongue. No. Wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of thy times and the strength of your salvation. What is that? It's the knowledge of this pattern. Who is Elohim? The archetype, original pattern of the universe. Who is also the resurrected Yahshua the Messiah. With those few words, thank you very much for your time and your patience. And with that, praise Yahshua.
We hope you have enjoyed this evening's class. Are there any questions or announcements? With that, we hold classes at 739 Ashland Terrace, Suite 207, Sundays from 11 to 1, Wednesdays from 7 to 9. May we all stand and be dismissed. Our doxology is taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto Him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all times now and ever. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right.
That was good. Thank you.
Very good. The archetype original.
Archetype.
Archetype. Archetype original pattern. That's right. You have a question? Somebody said a question?
Yeah, I can turn it off.
No, oh, I gotta turn it off. No, let anybody enjoy it. Let everybody enjoy it. What you got?
No, don't put me on that. You're already on there.
Yo, it's too late. Just ask the question.
I'm gonna ask you. We was watching you one time ago. Said how Jonah was back there
with Abraham or
something
like that. It
was in the same.
Who?
Jonah.
Yes.
You said Jonah and Abraham was like some in the same dispensation or something like that.
Job was in the same dispensation. Job existed in the same dispensation as Abraham. He was before Moses. Okay, so he's in the same time period, around that time period with Abraham and Melchizedek. So yeah, that's when that happened. He's in the same time period, and I don't know, is there anything, a question about that, or did I prove it, or whatever?
Yeah, prove it.
Okay, in the book of Job, the name Yahweh is not there, because he didn't know the name. He knew him as Elohim or El Shaddai, because Moses was the first one that Yahweh told his name to. And you're not going to find the name Yahweh in the book of Job. See, it's like what Dr. Kennedy used to say. Like, for example, there is a book of Enoch that exists out there. In fact, when we read Jude 14, that quote where he said about Yahweh coming with 10,000 from the sun, that quote came from the book of Enoch. All right, but Enoch didn't write that book. See. And the reason why we know Enoch didn't write that book was because in the book, in the original Hebrew, the name Yahweh is in that book of Enoch. Okay? Enoch didn't know the name Yahweh. And it's just really that simple. And that's the same thing with Job. See, Job was in the same dispensation as Abraham because he was before Moses. He didn't know the name Yahweh. So you're not going to find the name Yahweh in the book of Job. You'll find Elohim.
but you won't find Yahweh, because he didn't know the name Yahweh. Okay. And that's I can say about that, about Job. And that's the timeline when he existed now. Exactly what time he existed, I really can't say. I know it's in that dispensation. You know, it was before Moses now, whether he existed during the days of Abraham or Isaac or Jacob, I really can't say. But I can say he was in that dispensation. He was before Moses. He existed before Moses. Okay. Any other questions?
I did. Mine is about that. Saying hydrogen was the 92nd element.
Well, that's what Dr. Kinley called it, and the reason why he said that.
Yeah,
to distinguish it from the other 91 elements, which are threefold: proton, neutron, and electron.
Right.
He only classified it that way to show the distinction of the hydrogen atom, and to try to show that the hydrogen atom was really created in the image and likeness of Elohim. All right.
Because it has no neutron.
Right. It doesn't seem like it has a third part. Uh-huh. But the third part, which is unknown to scientists, but we know what the third part is. That's spirit law. The proton and the electron of the hydrogen atom is immersed in the spirit law, which is Yahweh himself. It emanates from that. Just as Elohim here, he emanates from the cloud. See?
The proton and electron emanates from spirit law.
From spirit law. It's in the textbook, the way Dr. Kinley has it. Yes. Spirit law, the most likely place is spirit than electron. For the hydrogen atom. See? And he calls it the 92nd because it's special. It's the first atom. It's the father of all the elements.
Hydrogen.
Yeah, if I had a periodic table of elements, yeah?
Yeah,
you can show us by the pattern. It goes by the pattern. You can go through the elements and see how the pattern fits on that periodic table of elements chart. And the guy who invented it, he received it in a dream. His name was Dmitry Ivanovich Mendeleev. He was a Russian scientist.
Yeah.
And he received it in a dream. See, and the people thought he was crazy until he showed that it made some sense, that he predicted three new elements and what slot they would be in.
Yeah.
Right? But it's by the pattern. Look. You can get closer if you want.
Camera. No, I'm training you today, woman.
Because, I love to come with anybody.
Y'all have
no phone
on the camera?
Yeah. See, look. See, let's push this like this. This is called Ohm's Law. This is the reason why the lights work. This stands for voltage, this is current, this is resistance. I took an FCC class once, and that's why I know about this. See, if I didn't know what the resistance was, I could find out what the voltage is and the current is, multiply the two, and it would give me the resistance. If I didn't know what the current was, I could take the voltage and divide it by the resistance, and that would tell me what the current is. This is Ohm's Law. This is why the lights work. Now, if you break Ohm's Law or you don't follow the parameters of Ohm's Law, then the lights won't work. Why? These natural laws are a type of the law of the spirit. See? They're a type of the law of the spirit. And if you break spirit law, the penalty is death. You break these natural laws, the penalty is death. If you was up on the roof and you slip, the law of gravity is not going to say, oh, man, you slipped. Well, look, I'm going to give you a pass because I know you didn't mean to slip. No, you're going to fall. Because that's the law. And if it's too high, you're going to die. See? So if you don't follow the parameters of these natural laws, the penalty is death. Why? Because it points to the law of the spirit. If you don't follow the parameters of the law of the spirit, the penalty is death. It's really that simple. And that's what these natural. Now we call it Ohm's Law because Yahweh showed it to a man named Friedrich Ohm's. What the principle is. We all know it's Yahweh's laws, all of them. But to distinguish them apart, we'll say, well, this is Ohm's Law, as opposed to some other sort of law like Newton's laws of motion.
or something like that. Or what Dr. Keeler used to use a lot called Bernoulli's principle. Uh-huh. I had never heard of Bernoulli's principle until I came to class. Then I looked it up and I found out, oh, it's the reason why a baseball curves. It's the reason why a plane flies, because of the shape of the wing, you know, lift plus drag. You know, when lift can overcome drag, that's the reason why something can fly. It's based on a principle. It's called Bernoulli's principle. All right, and I remember Dr. Kelly talked about it. I thought, wow, where are you coming from? Until I looked it up, I said, oh, okay. Now I see what he's saying. But does that kind of answer your question? No?
I need you to go back.
Go back to do what?
You explain why he's, when I think about proton,
neutron,
and electron, that's positive, negative.
Yeah.
You say that's within
the spirit law.
Which is Yahweh.
Which is Yahweh. Just like Elohim is in the bosom of the Father.
Yeah.
It's the same principle. That's what it's showing you. Elohim is in the bosom of the Father. Dr. Kinney would say it like this. Your heart is the throne of God on the 58th table. And it's, you know, which represents the bosom of the Father. It's in the most holy place.
Right.
The heart represents the law. Just like when they put the tables of stone in the Ark of the Covenant, they were heart-shaped. See, it represents the law of the Spirit that governed the Israelites. The same law that governs the universe, no matter what. See, you know.
So being that that was the first element,
mm-hmm.
and I know about that being this number one on the periodic chart. So you're saying that's likened unto Elohim?
Yahweh, pure spirit.
That's Yahweh.
That's Yahweh.
So helium, which is
the second element.
Uh-huh.
What's the symbol for helium?
H-E.
He, yeah. Elohim. Because see, everything is drawn out from hydrogen.
Okay.
Hydrogen, what is hydrogen? It's an odorless, colorless, tasteless gas,
right.
But highly flammable.
Right.
Well, Yahweh, pure spirit. Can't see him, can't touch him, but he's a consuming fire.
Okay. So it had nothing to do with, what was throwing me off, because I knew uranium is radioactive and can
be
down.
Yeah.
That's why.
I know, but if you read in there, he says herein classified in parentheses when he says 92nd atom. He's making the distinction between the other 91 elements,
gotcha.
Which are proton, neutron, and electron, as opposed to the hydrogen atom, which is a proton and electron.
Yes.
And he's drawing that out to show you that it is created in the image and likeness of Elohim, which is Elohim standing on the pavement of a sapphire stone. But he's in the bosom of the cloud. Just like the proton and the electron of the hydrogen atom is the same way, but it's in the midst of the third invisible part. That's how it says in the textbook, which is Yahweh, or spirit law. That's all he's making. He's just making a comparison, showing you, that's why we went over here, because cosmogony. Here, see Elohim, it didn't take all of Elohim to transform into one hydrogen atom. That's it. Just like it didn't take all of Yahweh to become Elohim. In part, not in totality. Well, the hydrogen atom is Elohim in part, not in totality. It's the same thing in principle. And then he just told it, be fruitful and multiply. Bam. One become two become, and then trillions and billions and trillions, we got a universe. But it started off with one. And it has to end with one too, which is Elohim. Because at the end, it'll tell you, and when all things are subdued and put under his feet, it is accepted, that Elohim is accepted, and that he himself must be made subject to Yahweh, so that Yahweh might be all in all. It started off that way, it has to end that way. Okay?
Got it. Thank you.
All right. Anything else, any other?
I know.
No? I know they want me to shut the camera off. But this is what we do. This is the thing. Take the time and just look at it. I mean, our father, he said this. I drew 7 charts and wrote 2 books. He also said something else. I've given you enough to say.
Yes.
If you take the time to look at it, and believe me, there is more than enough information on it than what you think. A lot of times people say, well, I ain't got nothing to say. Good. Let the chart speak then. Mm-hmm. It's got a lot to say, if you allow it. I always say this. The more you engage this vision, the more the vision will engage you. Because see, the thing of it is, it's not to be a correlation master. That's not the whole point of this.
The whole point of this is to understand how the pattern works, so that when you leave here, you have it. And you see, if you see how Abraham's going by the pattern, and all these people going by the pattern, and all these other things going by the pattern, you're going to come to the conclusion and say, hey, wait a minute. My life is going according to a pattern. I'm on this trip too. And then you can see where you're at. See, Dr. Kelly was saying this. If you knew where you was at, see, we said there were seven steps. If you knew where you was at on the pattern, let's say, if you knew you was at the door, that's where you were at, then you would know how many steps you were from perfection.
Yep.
You'd know that. You'd also know how many steps you were from destruction too. You'd know that as well. That's the whole idea, to be conscious of the ever-presence of Yahweh. How? You could by using a pattern. That's the whole point of what Dr. Kelly's doing. That's the object of the school, to teach you Elohim, the archetype original pattern of the universe. And that same pattern is in here. You operate according to that same pattern. We just go through the motions to see. But hopefully, it'll dawn on you and say, well, wait a minute. My life's going through the same pattern as well. Same thing. It's no different.
All right. Now we shall conclude.